And we are live.
Oh, hello.
I said what I said.
I said what I said. I'm not apologizing. Oh, so it's been a while. But we are finally back. Fingers crossed to a normal schedule once again. And I don't know about the rest of you, but I've been chomping at the bit to get back to playing D&D as much as possible.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. That's just me perpetually. Even when we're playing it regularly, I just want to play more of it.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
That's the danger.
It hurts when I can't play. It actually hurts.
Like, I said it during setup, but like I had started like falling into like the depths of DM burnout because we had been playing so long. And it's, you know, not because, you know, you don't enjoy the campaign or anything like that. It's just once you have too much time away from a campaign, you start doubting it. And then you start losing track of where everything is at and second guessing the story, or, you know, triple guessing the story. And then just doubt starts to weigh in.
Yep.
And then, so I've had a couple of those bouts throughout, you know, off nights and everything, trying to figure out what to do with best course of action and everything like that. But we're back again. So yeah.
What's and we up? All keep coming back for more.
I don't understand why I put you guys through some punishing situations and you still keep coming back for more. So
like it.
I must be doing something right. You're a bunch of masochists.
It's been a long time.
Yeah, little of column A, little of column B.
Yes. Both is good. Yep.
I will say,
we like the pain, we keep coming back.
Time off is also a curse because I'm now working on a Fallout campaign.
Yep.
Is glow in the dark making a comeback?
Possibly glow in the dark, but the official Fallout RPG. Official tabletop.
They have one of those now.
Yeah. I was looking at the book and everything, and I got like, I was super excited at the races that people could pick. People could choose to play as a Mr. Handy robot.
Nice.
I was like, oh, that's awesome. You could be like a Mr. Handy, or you can be a ghoul.
Wait,
or...
aren't we supposed to have an avatar one in the future?
You know,
I don't want to be that guy, but with Thursdays, we're starting to run out. We're starting to run out of evenings at this point.
Look, there's still Wednesday. There's still Sunday.
I don't know about you, but no, we're not. And
still Friday.
Yeah. And, you know, Sunday, so they can do more than one. Saying.
Yeah, and like, my mind is like, hey, we could just do Wednesday, just do it every other week that you do one day. One week is Fallout, the other week is Avatar, because your brain isn't, you know, misfiring constantly already.
Right.
Everyone with ADD on the cast, raise your hand.
Wait, what was that?
Everyone with ADD on the cast, raise your
hand. That was the joke, homie.
Give me one second here.
Somehow I think, I don't know.
Anyone want to do a Witcher campaign?
Yes.
Lord of the Rings campaign?
I'm in. Give me more.
My poor brain only works X amount of days. I can't help you here.
Yeah, the thing is, the thing is, with the introduction of like Bloodhunter and everything, I feel that Witcher campaign is just an all Bloodhunter D&D.
Yep.
Pretty much. Mm.
So Lord of the Rings campaign.
That's just D&D.
True.
That's D&D.
Harry Potter.
That's D&D with a higher fantasy setting.
Yeah.
It's D&D.
So Harry Potter is kids on brooms.
Yeah, kids on brooms.
Yeah, I mean, actually,
there's apparently another one that they've done for Harry Potter now. I have to check it out.
Unfortunately, Kids on Brooms has like a system to where the violence level is like really toned down. And if you've ever seen me DM a Mouse Guard campaign, that's very hard for me to do.
Oh, God.
The absolute bloodbath at the final.
Even fun. I love that.
The absolute bloodbath of the final fight that was for when we did RPG mixtape. I think I scarred poor Four on that one.
That being said, the two Mouse Guard games that we've played on this channel, I think, have been some of the best stories that we've ever done.
I love Mouse Guard. Mouse Guard has a special place in my
heart. Yeah, it was fun.
It's just.
And we still need to do part two of Tales in the Loop.
Yeah.
Or Tales from the Flood.
Things from the Flood. I haven't forgotten about it. I still have the books sitting over there, and it pops into my mind every once in a while.
Yeah.
And then, like, something like burning in the back of my mind. It's like, we need to do another Monsters and Childish Things game. Which, if nobody's seen that, it's pretty much JoJo's Bizarre Adventure, but your children with imaginary monsters.
That's cute.
I don't know what that means, but I'm on board.
If Magpie takes part in that one again, if we do it again, I'm just going to keep pushing her in the pool like I did before.
Oh my god.
Actually, speaking of Tales of Cthulhu is something I've always wanted to try at least once at some point.
Yeah, how did our Cthulhu game go, Fox?
Two episodes and everybody died? Did it make it to two episodes?
Yeah, I made it to two episodes.
Sounds about right.
Oh my.
Because that was
maybe an episode and a half before everyone was dead.
Because that was back when we were still doing two and a half hour episodes before we started pushing most of our games to 4 hours. So,
technically, our
one, I think it was, of the second episode, all of our characters were dead.
Yeah, it was a thing. Very true to Cthulhu games, but it was a thing.
I mean, if I could just make it's because I look at it and it's just like I have like all of my streaming stuff on my channel and stuff. And it's just like, can I push this away to do more D&D? it's like, but then what do I do with all these video games that I have? Because I was, you know, an irresponsible child and bought both Street Fighter 6 and Diablo 4 last weekend. So
I saw you playing Diablo 4.
I may or may not have gotten Diablo 4 myself.
It had Necromancer, so I had to buy it.
I'm running.
Someone took a week off work to play it.
Not me.
Okay, be fair, I've done that for MMO launches. Like, I will, like...
I did that when Dragon Age Inquisition came out.
If I'm at a job to where, like, an MMO's launching, and I'll just burn all the PTO I have just to play the MMO. Like, I did that I did that for New World. I took a week off of work when New World came out and just played it religiously. And then regretted it.
Sure. You did that.
Me too.
A couple months later. I regretted it because it was just like, this game was supposed to be great. And it wasn't what we expected.
Worst part is I ended up basically running an entire like faction on my server.
Mm-hmm.
That ate way too much time and energy. I had a burnout from that game.
This is why I was really happy.
The whole social experiment just no.
Now it's like the only MMOs that I'm playing right now are Final Fantasy 14 and Guild Wars 2.
This is what made me really happy that the Tears of the Kingdom to Zelda came out while I was on maternity leave. So I didn't have to take time off to play it.
Tears of the Minecraft.
Mm-hmm.
And Rosa just mentioned that Destiny Forged.
We need the arena fight.
The arena fights and some of those other things.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah.
That are going to happen.
Yep.
Suddenly I leveled my character up for that.
But I think we need to get started on this one.
Oh yeah, the thing we were supposed to do.
Yeah, the game that we're supposed to do. I mean, bear with Everybody's us, people. It's been
their shit in order.
It's been a while since we've seen each other on camera and everything, so you know, there's bound to be some catch up.
What was this about?
What were we doing? ADD? Yep. And then once everything gets situated, we need to start bringing back Behold Lore as well.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. And my cat,
yes,
is now up on my desk and is climbing right in front of my monitor. Because that's what she does. All right. Well, I will try to look at all of you as best as I can as she blocks half the monitor. But the last time that we left off, things went south really fast. After the bombardment of the temple where the Cult of Whispers had been calling home, seemingly burying the Whispered One, the group returned back to Echo Bay in order to kind of put everything together that they had experienced and give in reports what happened to the remaining members of the Hunters Guild, those who had stayed behind from the Great Hunt. When they got there, they found that there had been some sort of incident that happened. The streets were completely quiet and empty, even for a city that was under a drinking curfew. It was normal that people would still be out and about throughout the night. You explored Echo Bay a little bit and you came across a couple residents just laying on the ground in various buildings and in alleyways. And to the untrained eye, they would look to be dead. But upon further investigation, they were simply sleeping. Once you made it to the guild hall for the Hunters Guild, you discovered that a vast majority of the populace of Echo Bay had just instantly fallen asleep for some reason. A concern was that the magical wards around the town had failed and some sort of spell had enchanted a large portion of the community. Though, with dispatching a couple hunters, they confirmed that the seals were still up. A little bit of time passed, and the Whisper One had made contact, specifically to Rory, who tried to offer up a deal that they turn over Shara and Echo Bay would be spared. Of course, nobody took that deal. I would judge all of you heavily if you did. But what happened...
You don't judge me.
Oh, I judge you guys all the time for your choices that you make in these games.
Fair. The privilege of the DM.
The privilege of the DM, exactly. Privilege of the person who has all the answers sometimes.
I'll see y'all Thursday.
Yeah, right. But due to the refusal, as you were leaving Echo Bay before the designated hour of sunrise, you began to hear screams and just pure anger roaring from the city as all of those who were asleep sprung to life and began rushing like mad into the harbor waters, their blood slowly starting to turn the surrounding water just thick and red. And then a small portion of the storm that surrounds the Tricorn Isles seems to begin to bleed through the streets of Echo Bay as some sort of eerie fog. Unknowing what to do now with passengers in tow of the people who were still functioning in the city, those who were clambering, trying to get aboard ships that were or leaving without them. You took on about 20. Without any other ideas on where you could possibly go to provide these people safe harbor, you decided to set course back towards the Parsnip family scrapyard. And as we pick up, the day has been taxing for a lot of you. Throughout the first day of travel, you've pretty much left your tasks to the rest of the crew. Some of you needing a bit more personal time than others to reflect on what happened. And in the early morning of the second day, each of you get a small knock on your door from Bryant, informing you that Rory has found something. Apparently, she has been up all night. And he asks all of you that once you've gotten yourselves ready for the start of the day to please attend the captain's meeting.
Well, we are going to get dressed and we are going to go to the meeting. Captain calls, mateys. Time to go.
Yeah, same deal. Char's getting up and going straight to the meeting, looking very groggy and miserable after everything that's happened.
Yeah, it's been a rough night for all of you. You still get the effects of a full rest, but this wasn't one night where sleep came easy.
Pearl would head to the meeting as well. She'll pull herself together as, you know, to try to look as presentable as possible and check her reflection in the mirror and then head off to the captain's quarters.
I think I will be fashionably late.
As normal.
Yeah.
Pearl's hoping to get at least one large cup of coffee before the meeting starts.
Oh yeah, and Bryant has made sure to provide copious amounts of caffeine and alcohol for anyone who needs it. As you
Irish coffee it is.
As you slowly but surely begin to filter into the room one by one, you can see a very disheveled looking Rory sitting at the large map table where you've had a couple of your previous morning meetings. A strange looking tome is just flayed out, open on the middle of the table, and various notes and scribbles and other smaller books from Rory's person are just clambered about sporadically on the table as if she has been deep in study for hours.
Are any of the tomes or books or anything that's just kind of out in the open, are they anything that any of us recognize as something that we've seen her with or acquired recently?
I would assume that both Muir and Cannonball would recognize the large tome in the center of all this junk as it is the hag's tome that you had acquired from the dead hag's personal ship or dinghy, I guess you could call it.
Cannonball is probably pissed to the nth degree right now.
And she kind of sees the quiet anger on your face, and she just holds up a hand. Like, look, I know, I'm sorry, but we need this. As she kind of like spins the book around and pushes it across the table, and there is just this detailed chapter on this whispered one. I've been up all night looking into this bastard, and what I found is alarming. The rumors about the Kuotoa creating him are true to a point. It seems that he wasn't what he or what they said he was, a gibbering mouther, but a devil wishing to obtain godhood. And so he disguised himself as a gibbering mouther and began whispering demented and twisted words into the mind of a few of the Kuotoa priests, and it began a domino effect. What we're dealing with is, or what we dealt with, I should say, is someone who has a somewhat professional connection to the hags of the Crone's Cauldron.
At that name, you can hear, well, almost like a screeching sound. Cannonball's hands are grabbing onto the edge of the table, and his nails are digging into the wood at this point.
He acts as sort of a go-between for them and some of the brokers of the Hells, trading knowledge and power for I'd wish not to say that, they'll say it in polite company. The details are a bit disgusting. But now that he is somewhat freed from a anchor that temple was, he's more of a danger now.
Who is he? What's his name?
That the hags, well, the hag that had this tome anyway, very intelligently left out of his information. I believe that not even the remaining sisters over at the Crone's Cauldron know his true name.
But he's just a messenger. Or goes in between for information, I should say.
More of a power broker. But now that he's free and no longer anchored to that rubble outside of Echo Bay, there's no telling what he's going to do.
Any details of who sent him? Or who he was working closely with?
As far as the hags knew, he was a personal go-between for them. They would pay him whatever he demanded, and he would bring them power or knowledge.
When you say anchored, Rory, do you mean anchored as in had to be there, or was put there, or was somehow trapped there and we accidentally freed it?
Yes, unfortunately. Something went wrong when the Kuatoa began to help him ascend. He was trapped in that room that was known only to the quote-unquote chosen. But after the initial encounter with him from what Shara has told me, what Shara and those others who were inside have told me, combined with that, with the cannon barrage from our ship, that seal, that anchor was destroyed.
You don't trust fucking cults.
Oh, I agree. I am in no state of mind to argue that. Though it looks like the cultists themselves were, for the most part, innocent. Not many of them knew what exactly was going on, and they were just acting as a means to bring this Whispered One suitable sacrifices. They thought they were ascending to a higher plane of knowledge, and they just pretty much fed this thing.
Should have just killed them all.
I've already sent out letters to a couple of my contacts. I'm arranging to meet one once we get back to the scrapyard. With what I know, I need to begin to...
One of the cultists?
No. One of my contacts of my organization.
Oh. Okay.
With what I know and the information that I've gotten from this tome, I need to make an in-person report. This goes beyond anything that we can handle at the moment. And if anything, my organization can start getting the word out to more powerful allies.
Did it say anything in that book about how this thing was able to make, I don't know, a storm or whatever that was appear in Echo Bay? Because it looks an awful lot like the storm that's surrounding us. And that raises a few questions.
Unfortunately not. His powers are not well detailed in this tome. Though, being something that's ascended to some sort of a deity-like status, maybe he has the ability to influence the area around him. What we see as the storm may not actually be the storm in Echo Bay. It may just be a point of fear that everyone knows.
This is some pretty heavy shit. Should we maybe be heading back to Tidelight instead of the scrapyard? You know, give this information to the people who are paid to handle this kind of shit?
I thought of that. But I'm not sure if the smoke has cleared over all of our heads just yet as to what we went through in Tidelight. If we make our way towards the scrapyard, we can give the people below time to sort things out before reintroducing them into society as they start going on and leaking to everyone what happened. let them get their senses back before they start a panic.
I mean, it seems like the right time to panic.
Panic in a city is never good. That leads to more trouble. At this rate, we can get them taken care of, and my organization can work with them.
Pearl looks at Shara and says, Shara, just think this through for a second. If we go back to Tidelight with this story and we say, hey, we were investigating some cultists and we blew up a temple and we freed a devil. Can you fix it? How's that going to go down?
Well, I mean, we don't have to give them all the details. You know, we can just be like, hey, we were at Echo Bay and this shit went down. What the fuck's going on? You know, we don't have to tell them that, you know, we were at the source of it, or, you know, we had like a personal meeting with this devil god.
And what happens if somebody casts one of those truth spells on us?
We hit them real hard till the spell goes away.
Okay. Pearl looks very dubious.
Did it say what type of devil this creature was?
Just one who had higher ambitions. If that's something that can be believed.
Great. You can see that Jenka is very visibly pissed off. In the sense of her facial expression, as her arms are crossed and you can see that her face is upset. She's just kind of just staring at the book the whole time.
Yup. Cannonball's expression is pretty much matching that at this point.
Rory sort of notices the look on your faces and she puts her hands up. She's like, just to come clean about everything, I haven't looked at anything else in this tome. It seemed to have opened directly to the information on the Whispered One simply by my thinking of it. What else is contained in this tome, I do not know, and at the moment I do not wish to know.
Yeah, after the fact that she lied about picking up the tome in the first place back on the boat, Cannonball's expression is one of not really believing her, if that makes any sense.
You're pressing X to doubt very hard.
So hard that, like, yeah, my eyebrows are, well, his eyebrows are almost like a unibrow at this point, but yes. There is now a complete lack of trust there, unfortunately.
And I don't think anybody can blame that.
You're still pretty sure you burned the book, but that's a different problem.
So, Rory, just to clarify, where exactly did you get this tome from?
She kind of looks over at both Mirror and Cannonball. It was in the chest that I had Esteban bring on board from the ship that had the dead hag on it.
Oh, come now, Captain. No need to be shy. You mean the chest you had Esteban secretly bring back on board behind our backs after everybody agreed to destroy it?
Yes, that.
And what else is in there?
Oh,
if you want us to believe you, if you want us to...
She kind of, like, looks over to the chest that's just, like, haphazardly just tossed open to the side. over by her bed. It's still open, and there is a just that very large dodecagon made, what looks to be made out of paper, sitting there. There's that thing too, but I haven't even bothered looking at it. Something just told me that knowledge of the Whispered One would be in this book. Now that I have the knowledge that I need to make a report. This unfortunately means I'm going to need to leave all of you for the time being.
Tell your little organization what's going on. I'm sure we'll trust them completely.
Don't expect us to keep the captain's seat warm for ye, matey.
I don't expect you to keep anything warm for me. I understand that I've been secretive on some things and lied about others. It's just the means of my profession. I apologize if I burnt any bridges along the way because of that, but they weren't due to greed or anything evil in nature. It was more for knowledge and protection.
Yeah, I mean, don't like worry about it or anything, as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, like, we've worked together a few times. This is totally fine. Shit you do way above my pay grade. I'm just a hired hand. You need another one, I'm here for you.
Thank you for that, Shara. You may be getting letters, missives from me from time to time. If anything of interest pops up, any information that we may find about this Whispered One or the Ravon Training Company or anything of that nature, I will be sure that the Silver Tongue's information is shared with all of you.
So, Rory, what do you plan to do with that chest and that white paper thing and the book and all of these things?
The book I'll be taking with me to the Silver Tongue. They'll know what to do with it. They have those proficient in dealing with such hag items. They'll either lock it away, or they'll cloister it for study, or whatever they do. But I'll be sure that this tome doesn't see the light of day or it fall into the hands of the public again. The dodecagon, I guess I would take that as well. I have no idea what it is, but it being a hag item, there's a very high chance that it's nothing good. Unless any of you can think of a reason as to why you would want to keep it on board.
No. Do I know what that is? Specifically, what it could be used for?
If you took some time to, like, look it over, you may possibly get an idea. But right now, it just looks like a giant D12.
I wouldn't mind taking a peek at that.
And she just kind of like motions over to the open chest at the foot of her bed.
Now, go over and grab it and go back into my corner and just start observing it, just kind of hyper focused.
As you pick it up, it's got a bit of heft to it. It weighs about as much as like a basic medicine ball, but it's just made like the surface of it is just like this very smooth paper. Now, are you looking to just, like, study it, like, give it a quick study, or are you trying to do like the spend an hour do an identify type thing.
I definitely want to do the spend the hour.
Okay.
I want to learn more about this thing.
Most definitely something that you can do.
So actually, while so we're
definitely focused on it in the meantime,
while we're all here and talking about this weird shit, do any of you recognize where in the world this is? And I'm gonna pull out the letter that I picked up that that creature on our ship dropped, the map of that jungle area. I'm gonna lay it out for everyone so everyone can see clearly what's on it. See if anyone recognizes where this map might be depicting.
And anybody who is taking a look at this map, if you want to give a survival roll, you most definitely can.
I'll take a look.
Having been on the sea quite a bit on the Isles, I definitely will as well.
I got a 21.
And my first bad roll of the day. That would be a 12.
A 12. And a 21. Is anyone else taking, doing a bit of an investigation on this map, or is it just Echo and Pearl?
I haven't been anywhere useful enough to be able to help with that.
What about Cannonball? Has Cannonball or Echo been around enough to...
Oh, I rolled.
Yeah.
You rolled, okay. And Jenka, what about
Jenka? Jenka's looking at the little, or the giant paper D12, I should say.
Which is unfortunate because I rolled really high.
Okay. I mean, I did roll a 20 on the survival. If that does gives you anything,
that does.
30 or 20, but
That will most definitely help out for this. So taking a look at it, the three of you sort of study over this small map that Shara provides, and it almost looks like one of the jungles that is home on Terramir, the island that is home to Tidelight, one of the deeper jungles near the western coast, along that inner piece of water that the three islands surround that no ship dare try to sail across.
Okay. So be on the northwest side of Terramir?
It would be here. Let me bring up the map on stream here so everyone can see. And then let me get a little marker here. So it's about like right there.
Okay.
So west side.
Yeah, like the far west side of Terramir. Like through one of its one of the more deeper jungles.
And just to clarify, that would not be a place you'd go by ship because of the center part. You'd go overland.
You would have to, this would be something you would have to go overland for. Any ship that's tried to go through that inner part of the sea right here, as I click on OBS trying to get it to ping, right here has had nothing but troubles and catastrophe happen to it.
You can't even sail the coast then.
Any ship that starts going in there slowly but surely starts breaking down, and the very few people that have survived those treks come back changed. A bit of madness sets in on them, and they're never the same again.
I don't know what you'd be talking about.
Well, shot. There's been...
Is that a spoiler alert?
Right?
I don't think cannonballs even touch that part of the ocean.
Oh god, how would it get worse? Just kidding.
Cannonballs functional.
Turn around and find out, as they say.
Yeah, cannonball is functional. Most of the people who go through that way are not function. They can't function anymore. Mm. It's a bunch of it's a bunch of like maddened babbling in everything.
Okay.
We're talking clinically insane.
Yeah.
Well, Shara, I've seen a lot of maps at the monastery, and this definitely looks like it's on Tremere. But we'd have to go by land. It's over on the western side.
Oh yeah, I don't want to go here. Yeah, no, this map, it came from, you know, the creature that was on a ship briefly in Echo Bay. It came from that creature, and, you know, this big red X here that says, look for me here, right on this spot. I have no interest in looking for this creature.
So that's a place to avoid.
Yeah, although it's concerning now that it's so close to home. Well, home for me, anyway.
It is awfully close.
Home for a few of us.
But, I mean, I guess, you know, now we have a location to point all the armies towards, right?
Sure. Just have to get word to them.
I ask that you leave any information to provide to the armies, to me and my associates. We'll ensure that the right people are told that way nothing is, well, bungled in the handlings.
Right.
The last thing we need is information being leaked out to, say, the Ravon Company.
I mean, are they really that bad, though? I mean, they're bringing in supplies for us from outside of the storm. Yeah, they've got a monopoly on it, but... I mean, they're kind of helping the islands, aren't they? They're a corporation, so, of course, they're shady as fuck. But they're helping, right?
There seems to be a difference between the Ravon Trading Company and... their subgroup known as Ravon Acquisitions, matey.
So you're just trying to stop this acquisitions for fine now, not the trading company. What's the difference between the two?
We
use the same name, almost.
From what we've gathered, it sort of falls under the same umbrella.
Okay, I get it now.
And we all know umbrella corporations be dangerous, AD.
Something about zombies.
Sorry, couldn't help it.
Last thing we need is information getting out to the Ravon Trading Company, and then something being leaked over to Ravon Acquisitions, and then, well, we can have people looking to obtain godhood on their own.
I take it you've had some bad dealings with this... Ravon Acquisitions?
Not necessarily. Ravon Acquisitions tends to try to keep to itself and tries to wheel and deal on its own. Our run-in with them was the first time I had any sort of personal experience with them. You've seen how they operate with people who just witnessed what they were trying to do.
Can I do an insight check on Rory concerning what she said about how everything will be handled by Silver Tongues?
Sure.
Ooh, that was a nat 20 plus 5 for 25.
You really want to trust her. You really want to trust her as to what she's saying right now. You get a feeling that maybe she's not telling you everything, but you can't put your thumb on it.
So, just make sure I have this right. You guys witnessed something done by the acquisitions group and then had a run-in with them? What happened?
It was...
Kinda, sorta.
We witnessed a arms deal that went very, very wrong. But the way that we got in, we were posing as... Well, I was posing as a city guard, a private, that they had bribed in order to keep a lookout in the upper decks, and the rest of our companions here were hired muscle that I brought on. And all was said and good, all was good, and we thought we got away with it, and then they found the individual who was bribed and made an example of him. And they found us and tried to make an example of us. And thankfully, we came out on top on that, but one of them got away.
They tend towards the violence. That's good to know.
And it happened in my company, my grandfather's, one of my grandfather's company's warehouses, and being a purser on one of his ships, and it being a family business, I had the keys to help them get in.
Also, the warehouse exploded.
That wasn't me.
So the arms deal went that bad. Wow.
Well, actually,
no, that was after the arms deal.
Why would they explode the warehouse after the deal?
I don't know. It's weird.
Pearl crosses her arms and gives Shara a withering look.
But also, yeah, they like straight up. You hear a very small scoff.
Jenka just kind of scoffs in the corner, like, yeah.
But right, yeah, I mean, yeah, from what we've been told so far, what very little we've been told and learned about this Ravon group, yeah, they'll just like murder a bunch of people just for those people being in the wrong place.
That's good to know.
We lost Cannonball. There we go.
It's also nope, now I understand next. Why I'm you greeted me with such hostility at first.
Computer crashed, rebooted everything. We're good. Sorry about that.
Welcome back.
I missed the last 2 minutes. My apologies. Like I said, the whole thing crashed on me.
We're just going over what happened at the warehouse in Tidelight.
Perfect.
And did you catch the insight check on what Rory had? I insight checked Rory's claim that she made that the Silver Tongues would take care of who to tell, et cetera, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
And I did it was a nat 20 plus 5. So.
Perfect.
Well, yes and no. Apparently, I feel I should trust her, but there's something that's not 100%.
It's me, Rory, and Métis. There's always something that's not
100%. Yeah. There's always something that isn't being shared.
Actually, I'll stretch that to the party and say I don't think there's any of us who are technically 100%.
So... Rory, if you want to make a copy of this map to take with you, then I'm going to keep the original on me in the safety of this bag that I've got. Because I don't know if there's any sort of, like, tracking that can be done on this, but I think it'll be safe in the bag and not, you know, out in the open. So make a copy while you can.
She gives you a nod. I think that's a very good idea, Shara. If you don't plan on investigating it, we can definitely get somebody out there and look at it.
I certainly myself don't plan on investigating it when I know absolutely nothing about what's happening right now. It may change in the future, but right now I just want to deal with one problem at a time.
Speaking of problems, what are we doing with the 20-somewhat odd people we have on board? We're just dropping them off somewhere, or...?
They'll disembark with me at the... at the scrapyard. I have a contact meeting us there. We'll work with them, make sure they're taken care of, make sure they know what to say and what not to say when they make their way into Tidelight. Unfortunately, this is going to require a bit of a cover-up right now. We can't have it getting out just into the general public that Echo Bay has, well, in, for lack of a better term, been swallowed by the storm.
We're probably on a bit of a timer in that regard, though, because, you know,
yeah.
Cities, they got ships coming and going to each other all the time. So eventually somebody's going to go, where the fuck are all the ships from Echo Bay, right?
You're not wrong. We could...
That's where my grandfather, like all the metals we use come from, that island.
Yes, we are. This is definitely just plugging our finger into a hole that's going to get bigger as time goes on. But anything we can do to prevent a panic from breaking out for a single day is for the best.
I mean, eventually people are going to start panicking over the lack of product coming out.
Oh, I'm very aware.
It's a major trade hub.
Very aware that a lot of the metals are going to be painfully missed until we can discover what had happened. My hopes is that it's just Echo Bay that was hit. Some of the smaller towns, the villages, the mining towns that are all throughout Asboro can possibly get together and a makeshift dock be built somewhere until Echo Bay can be reclaimed.
Might be a good idea to invest in some ammunition for the ship before everyone finds out, because the cost of things will go up until they get things reestablished.
Good thinking.
Bryant nods. Oh. Good thing we're heading back to the scrapyard then. We can talk to Pyro and see if he can't give us a bit of a discount on the ammunition.
I have been missing that boy.
Yeah, maybe we get that discount before we tell them what happened. Because, you know, with all this metal trade cut off, scrap is going to be worth a fortune.
Yeah. They're not in business right now. Point.
Well, that is true, but they are also family, so... We take care of each other first, and then... You can guarantee anybody else come in looking for scrap is going to be charged a very hefty price.
See, we must have grown up in very different households, because if this was reversed and these were like my brothers and sisters, they'd charge me double.
The Parsnip family isn't greedy, and we look after our own.
Oh, they're not my brothers and sisters. They're not greedy either. They're just... They're assholes. But also, I would do the very same to them.
As you said, difference in upbringing.
I think the important piece is that if someone else did it to them, you'd stand up for them.
Oh, we'd all gang up on them.
Yes. That's the important piece. Very similar at the monastery. You might not have actual brothers and sisters, but you treat them that way.
It's just what siblings do to each other, right?
Yes. You can mess with them all you want, but someone else? Mm-mm.
Exactly.
So what are your... Well, I can't even ask that. What... Does anyone have any plans as to what you all are going to do once we make landfall?
Once we make landfall, no. Once we get back to the sea, I have a couple of ideas.
Cannonball gives a little bit of a roguish smile.
Could be capping the ship. What's where he goes?
Sorry, one at a time, mateys. I'm old and I can't hear it if you all talk at the same time.
Tentacle coming out of his ear.
How old is Cannonball?
Now that'd be one of the questions. I can't count that high.
Go ahead, Earl.
Visually, if you look at the man, it's a little hard to tell because he's got that tanned skin of someone who spent way too much time in the sun, being somebody who's been a lot on ships. So you could guess probably anywhere between 30 to 40, but 40 plus actually, but it's just hard to tell.
His age is, I've seen some shit.
Yeah. The sickly tan skin, the runes on his skin, sickly green runes on
the
his
tentacles.
Skin, plus the tentacles.
Just, yeah.
Your guess is as good as his at this point.
He's that RPG character that just has the question mark for age.
But yeah, so as I said, well, as Cannonball said, he has a few ideas once we get back to the sea. But staying on land is not a proposition that is super attractive to him, considering the recent state of events.
Well, I mean, before he disembarking, who's going to be captaining the ship?
Well, there was
newcomer, okay?
There was talk that I was sort of the captain in name, but the official stance was that Jenka was going to be the captain.
Her face snaps up from focusing on this item, and she's like, "Wait, what?"
Yes, that's pretty much what was decided. Was I wasn't really much of an experienced sailor, but I'm good with people, so I was just going to be like the face for like when we needed to do any sort of business dealings or anything like that. And on the official sense, you were the one to take the mantle as captain.
I'm shit at talking to people.
Let's be real, matey. It's not like anybody else but me was running the show here. If you want to give the orders, that's fine. I'll keep things running squeaky clean.
So basically, every first officer in existence.
Literally every first mate in existence like to this.
Yep.
Captains don't have to be personable. They just have to make a decision.
Yep. Then we get to shit talk it and make it happen.
Not wrong. Fuck.
Hope you like tomatoes, matey.
Fine.
It's like, well, on the plus side...
Fine. I don't like it, but whatever.
She's like, you get this cabin?
And on the upside, if anyone disagrees with you, you can stab them.
Or throw them off the ship.
I mean, I'll do that. I don't need to be captain to do that. Let's be honest here.
Without being questioned.
And as captain, you get an extra share of whatever bounties we get.
It's true.
Fine. Freaking move my shit into here, but I don't want people whining to me all the time, okay? You can figure shit out on your own sometimes too, okay?
Sorry, matey, that comes with being captain. Enjoy!
Cannonball kind of like waves at her.
Fuck.
Who gets pip duty?
Not me!
I'll have a rotation chart.
And yet another thing Echo doesn't know, so you guys can throw it at her. She doesn't know what she's getting into. You can manage this one.
Fine. Not until we make port, though.
No, of course, of course. I won't let the crew know that I'm leaving until we get to shore. That way we don't cause a mutiny.
Hey, so, I know, like, you two are, like, trying to be a thing or whatever, but you're not taking Bryant with you, are you? Because he's a damn good cook.
She kind of, like, both, like, her and Bryant kind of give you, like, a very confused look.
Cannonball bursts out laughing.
Everybody needs some company. I'm not ragging on it. I'm just saying, you're a good cook. I want you to stay.
And they kind of, like, look at each other and, like, back to Shara, and, like, you could tell there's a bit of embarrassment, but, like, neither one of them own up to it. And Brian shakes his head, like, I'm not going anywhere. I'm the ship's cook. I'm sort of, well, now with Rory leaving, I'm sort of the one who has the connections to any sailors that we need.
Good, good. I'm sure we can find...
Well, if you guys were pumping uglies while she was captain, I guess I'll take over.
Cannonball just and starts rubbing his forehead like he's got the biggest
both of them
migraine.
Both of them get very, like, red in the face, and Rory kind of, like, shakes her head, and so does Brian. He's like, nothing like that happened. We were very professional.
Yeah, it wasn't quite to that stage yet, I don't think.
I mean, I'll stay professional.
Either way, Métis, we haven't seen them with their pants off. Who knows if they were bumping uglies or if they're not so uglies.
Can we please get back to the conversation at hand?
At hand. I see what you did there, Métis.
He just, like, shakes his head and throws up his hand. He's like, if anyone needs me, I'll be in the kitchen as the cook.
We'll be sure to send Rory that way.
Great, I scared him off.
Well, at the very least, Cannonball doesn't look like he wants to kill someone anymore, so you know what? We'll take it. Welcome distraction.
Well, Captain, or shall I call ye Captain-to-be? I think the question we were asked earlier still stands. What be the plan next?
As he looks at Jenka here.
Oh, no, no. I said not until we get to port. Address me then.
Well, here's the thing, matey.
Well, sounds like the captain has spoken.
Your answer here kind of determines who comes back on board and who stays at port. You might want to address that at some point.
Well, so far you are not in my favor when I said address me when we get to port.
That'd be your decision, matey. I know my worth.
It will be when I get to port. Well, like, no, I'm not doing this right now, no.
Well, technically, matey, until we get to port, then I outrank you. So your answer, please, if you will. I'd be grateful. Sorry, we still waiting until port.
I'm just going to take the item and go back to your room.
That's so, what I thought.
As this conversation is going on, a bit of time has indeed passed, and Jenka, you've pretty much gotten a feel for this item that you are holding. And while it's technically not a magical item, there is a bit of magical life inside of it. Can you give me You're a blood hunter, right?
Yes, I am.
Can you give me a, let's call it an arcana roll with advantage?
Let me see my character sheet here. Oh, I'm actually proficient in arcana. Oh, thank God, with advantage. Okay, that is a nat 20 for 25.
You are holding a dragon's egg.
Fuck you, three.
Specifically, specifically a paper dragon.
Origami dragon, what?
Yep, an origami dragon.
Ashcon or Griffin, Jenga's gonna get her dragon? Yeah!
I thought dodecahedron was going with Rory, though.
Now you have to get probably have Jenga's hands. She did not say. She said she'd probably off my cold dead fingers. She said probably, unless you guys had an idea for it. So, guess what?
Jenga's I have an idea it. For it.
Fight me.
Hey.
Fought for you want to go through the egg, I will fight for this egg, goddammit.
You want to go through the pains of raising a dragon, you do that.
Don't know about ye, matey.
I went through the pains of raising a griffin. No regrets.
Don't know about ye, matey. It's on you to clean it. A dragon on a freaking boat sounds like a terrible idea.
I will teach it. Oh shit, what's that one spell? Where I can turn it flat as paper. And then it's fine.
You mean between. You mean between what? Captaining, keeping the dragon? The whole nine yards, eh, matey? When will you sleep, if you don't mind me asking?
You know what? You what? None of you are here. I don't even know how big this is gonna be. Jenga's just in her corner, just super happy that she has a dragon. Paper or no?
Just be clear, I'm not cleaning up the messes when it goes pee on the deck. That's on you. It's your pet.
Oh, and no one in the crew is cleaning the pee on the deck.
I can think of a couple people that can pee to clean up the pee on the deck.
Pim?
All Hydra, so help me, I will kill all the damn thing if it touches any of my stuff.
Do I know anything about Paper Dragon specifically, or if it's just something that's completely
I was mistaken.
Out of
it's,
this world.
It's not a Paper Dragon, it is a Paper Drake. But...
Aww.
My decision still stands to keep it.
You don't know much about them, as they are a bit rare. They're a rarity amongst, like, the known dragons and dragon light creatures, though they are small. They're small creatures. And you know not to let them around books, as they at times they just decide to erase ink and text from parchment to make aesthetically pleasing patterns. And at other times they go through and they sort of spell check everything and make grammatical changes and whatnot.
That's kind of cute. Oh, thank God I have my own spell checker. Oh, thank God.
Fox type, they just rearrange words and just generically fuck up books and parchment.
It's Clippy the dragon.
Because they can.
Yeah. It's Clippy the dragon.
I send a message to someone saying, like, this shit is fucked up, and it gets, this shot is ducked up. It's like, wait, what?
It's autocorrect.
Damn it.
An autocorrect.
Damn, autocorrect.
How would you like me to help?
I see you're writing a letter. I see you're copying a spell. Here, can I help you?
Oh God.
Do I know if this egg is similar? If it's similar to like any other egg, where, you know, keep it warm, all that stuff, or is it unique because it's paper?
You are muted.
Oh, you are muted.
No, I am not muted. Evie is laying on my button again. She got mad because I stopped holding her head.
How dare you?
But yeah, she's putting all of her weight on my mixer right now. You don't necessarily know what sort of care goes into the the technical nursing of the egg, though judging from it still seemingly being healthy at this point in time, after, you know, being on the hag ship for, you know, gods know how long, and then just in a chest buried underneath Rory's floorboards, it seems to be doing just fine.
Okay.
Just think, Jenka, instead of having a parrot on your shoulder, you can have a little paper drake.
I mean, that's pretty
that changes amazing, all the maps.
And if I were to become captain, that's going to be amazing. You have to stay out of the bathroom. This thing is going to need some training.
Yeah, good luck.
Oh, God. Paper drake. Jenka can't be in charge of maps anymore.
They're pretty much cats that have access to ink. On the plus side, though, they can give magical tattoos.
Magical tattoos? Okay, yes. I mean, I was already sold, but yes. Jenka gonna get tatted up. Wait, every morning she has a new tattoo. Everyone's like, what?
I'm sorry, what?
I have materials for it.
Yeah, right. Yep. All right. Jenka's, for now she's going to keep this to herself.
Okay.
So does she share that she's got...
kind of in her room.
Does she share that she actually has a dragon egg or no?
Not at this time.
Okay.
She's kind of still mulling over the... She's in pouty face right now because of the information that was still given from Rory, so she's not exactly in a chatty mood at the moment.
So we don't know that we're going to call it Clippy.
Not yet.
As long as we don't call it Blippy. As long as we don't call it Blippy, I'm fine.
Microsoft Sam. So unless anybody has anything,
how much time is it before we get back?
I was just about to get to that. Delay. You got a couple days. Once this day started, before all of you got up, Rory sort of issued a full sail command. And so your ship is sort of flying across the ocean. So you've got a couple days left on the sea until you reach the scrapyard. Technically, moving at double speed, you're going to be there about 3 days instead of six. But since, unless somebody is taking over helm duties or anything like that, Everything that is going to need to be rolled at a full sail, like double speed sort of thing, since it's sort of a bit reckless, is going to be done off the crew stats.
I'll probably, in a day or so from now, take over my regular shift at the helm. I don't think Chara would really have anything else to do, but she will take another day to herself before doing that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think Pearl would do something similar. I mean, it's all been very upsetting, but I think she is more comfortable doing things on the ship and would be up in the crow's nest and maybe keeping take the busy. Same shift as Chara or something like that, I think.
Okay. So what I'll do then is I will roll for the first day here. Oh, perfect. You guys are fine. first roll of the die for me that wasn't for Rory, and it's a nat 20. So first day, full sail speed, you guys, the ship is perfectly fine. No strain on the hull or on any of the sail rigging or anything like that. You guys just happily flying about.
Good job, Pib. I see the lashings had the desired effect.
I mean, you know what? Started out with a knot anchored, so that helped.
You know what? Because you said that, he's the one sailing the ship.
Yeah, I don't remember what he did last time.
Cannonball's definitely
wasn't good.
Cannonball's definitely praising him for, you know, not effing up and sailing it so smoothly this time around.
Meanwhile, Echo's very confused because in her eyes, Pim has been perfect.
Crew morale.
I believe
is
he forgot to hoist anchor.
Yeah, that's what he did. Mm-hmm.
Or weigh the anchor, I guess, technically.
It's like, what's this word, hoist?
Yeah, weigh. He didn't weigh the anchor.
Well, I mean, to be fair, you know, when he goes into ogre form, he may be able to hoist the anchor.
Not for all.
So is there anything anybody wants to do within these 3 days of travel, or do we just want to speed it up to you making landfall?
I have a few things, actually.
Okay.
First, I don't know if you remember back from, like, I believe the first, second episode? When we went, for the first time we got to the scrapyard, right? Mm-hmm. I got my hands on a certain holdout pistol.
Yep.
You did mention there was a marking on it.
I remember mentioning something of a marking.
Yes. Now, I'm sorry for asking this, like, 4 episodes later.
4 episodes in, a couple weeks later.
Yeah. So, I mean, if you need to think about it and get back to me on that, that's fine.
Let me see if I have it written down. If
Cannonball would definitely like to identify where this thing came from and if he can get his hands on more for, you know, asking for a friend, of course, type of situation.
Of course. What did I tell you that pistol did? I remember it was something.
1d4 plus sneak attack damage. 1d4 as if my level was that of a rogue.
That is correct. There's a derringer that can do sneak attack with
limited,
damage.
Yep, with limited range to 15 feet, if memory serves correctly.
So you're trying to identify the symbol that is etched into the barrel?
Yep, we're looking for the maker, basically.
So the symbol itself is less that of the maker, like any sort of maker's mark or anything, and more of a bit of a arcane symbol that sort of imbues the enchantment into the gun itself.
Okay.
So instead of you carrying like enchanted ammunition that would pass through the gun, the gun itself enchants whatever ammunition is put into it.
Oh, okay. You did mention also that it always has a bullet in the chamber. It auto-reloads.
Yeah.
Okay. That's true. I remember that now. Okay, so there is no maker's mark on it then.
There is no maker's mark. It's just like the arcane runes to imbue the enchantment into the gun.
Cool. Second thing here, I would very much also enjoy, if possible, trying to talk to the 8-ball in my chest.
You're talking about Zatrot, right?
Yes, I am.
Okay.
Talking about Zatrot.
I'm like, did I put anything else in your chest?
No, just Zatrot. Zatrot's enough.
Look,
thank you.
Look, I have to try to remember, because Cannonball's got some weird stuff that's happened to him in his past.
Yo. No, we are talking about the stuff you did, not the stuff he had done to him prior to that.
Okay.
A few things. First of all, Cannonball talked to Zatrot here and, you know, the usual, like, go stand in a corner kind of thing. In his own cabin, preferably.
Just go stand in a corner and whisper at his chest.
Yep.
Okay.
nothing creepy going on here, I promise. And yeah, no, just look at his chest and basically, you know, do the usual here. Zitrot, meaty, can you hear me?
Unfortunately.
Oh, come now. I've left you alone for what? At least 24 hours. That should be a record.
Were it that were a joke. What do you need, mortal?
Nothing. Good news for ye, matey. We're about to make for Tidelight.
And how is this good news?
It's good news because Ravon Trading Company gets there quite often.
The Which trading means, company.
Aren't ye looking for Ravon?
I am looking for the Ravon, not the company, not their ships.
Matey, but the Ravon, I'm assuming, is the head of the company if it be named after him, yes?
That would be your guess. I have been out of the loop, as you would say, in regards to political standings or changes throughout the years.
Well, let's make it simple then, matey. Considering it be the only thing called Ravon around here, it's probably a good place to start. Just letting ye know that you're... Well, my side of the deal is at the very least progressing, and ye be not forgotten. Now please don't eat my soul, thank you.
I have no interest in your soul.
I'll take it.
But yes, anyway, he's simply going to inform at the very least Zitrot that they are headed in a direction that should at least yield some semblance of information as to what they're looking for. Before, I'm assuming, I mean, does Zitrot have anything else to add to that, or are we just closing?
No, he doesn't, the shirt back? Like, anytime you talk to him, it seems like he wants the conversation to be over as soon as possible.
Sounds about right. When you don't want your taxi driver to talk to you.
Got yeah, it. Exactly. Exactly. He's sitting in the Uber and he doesn't want the driver talking to him.
Got it.
Like, unless you have some sort of information about Ravon, he sort of tries to either ignore you or stop the conversation as fast as possible.
Well, at the very least here, you know, we're letting him know we're on our way to something that might yield results, which is better than, you know, him being stuck in a frickin' basement not knowing what's going on. Cannibal is just going to ask one small question, and we'll see what happens to him, but he is going to ask.
If I may, matey, here, I'll try to be as polite as possible, but what would be your problem with this Ravon? Simply so I know what I'm getting myself into and, you know, don't have my head blown off.
Give me a charisma roll.
With pleasure.
Just straight up charisma.
Straight up charisma? All right. Let me get to my... Right, sorry, computer crashed earlier. I have to get back into roll 20. I forgot. One sec. Furious typing ensues. 2 seconds, because clearly the Cloudflare wants to check. And now for some reason, it's having me log in a second time, and we are in. Okay, let's see this. That is going to be a 11 plus, I believe, 4. I will confirm in a second. Sorry, I forgot to turn roll 20 back on earlier. Yep, that is plus 4. So that is going to be a 15.
15, okay. I guess you've been a decent enough host to get somewhat information as to why I have such a grudge against this Ravon. Specifically, Cassius Ravon. At an earlier point in his life, he was my herald. He was supposed to open the way for me to awaken and once again ascend into my rightful place of power. But on the day of my reawakening, he and his meddlesome troop of humanoids sealed me away again. Turned my body into a municipal art piece, where it still stands as a symbol of my defeat. And now I am here, an eye embedded into the chest of a human, dreaming of the day that I can have my revenge.
Well, small question, matey. Why go as an eye after the one who, quote-unquote, because we both know it ain't quite that way, but quote-unquote defeated you instead of simply going back to your body? Wouldn't that be more cost-effective?
Would that I could. But my eye was detached from my body as the battle ensued and, well, somehow wound up in that possum family's scrapyard. And by the laws of my kind, we cannot operate outside of our bodies unless a living being makes physical contact with us.
And that'd be where I came in.
Yes.
Well, matey, if ye still rather go after Ravon instead of your own body, then I'll of course abide by the terms of our accord.
From my understanding, Ravon has the way through the storm.
Ah, your body be outside the storm.
Yes.
Not from around here, I see.
Hence why I am an eye embedded into your chest, and not my glorious form.
Right. Well, for all it's worth, and I know ye did it simply to preserve your mode of transportation, but from my measly mortal perspective, I do extend my thanks for...
And you can see that Cannonball is kind of like spitting out the word thanks. He's not having a good time of it. But, you know, he's still extending thanks for, you know, the earlier situation here where, when they were facing the, well, I can't even call it the gibbering, you know, monstrosity anymore, because we know it's not that anymore, but...
Not anymore.
Mystery, devil, demon, whatever, X in the temple there.
He sort of, he gives a half frustrated sigh. He's like, don't look into it too much. I was preserving my, as you say, mode of transportation. The last thing I wanted to do is to have you die down there and be trapped in that God's forsaken place.
Well,
it was more a mode of self-preservation than anything.
Well, from the conscious, self-aware, and definitely self-preserving mode of transportation ye be riding on's perspective, matey, thank ye nonetheless.
I will repay your thanks as soon as we take care of Ravon.
Well, matey, considering the accord we have going, it's just as much my interest as it is yours to find him.
And pause, did he just say, as soon as we take care of Ravon?
Mm-hmm. He hasn't been keeping his secret that he wants his revenge.
Oh, no, I know, but the initial accord was for him to be delivered to Ravon. Not for us to fight Ravon with him, just so we're very clear about the wording that was used on the accord. Though we're not bringing this up exactly right this instant, let's be real. All right. Yeah, no, so I guess at this point he's probably done talking with me and Cannonball said what he had to say. Let's leave the leave it to other people.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anybody else have anything they want to take care of during this 3-day trip?
Would I be able to start a clock and train for proficiency in sleight of hand?
You are on a ship with pirates, yes. I believe that there are some...
Stealing everyone's shit.
Yeah, I'm scared pirates are stealing shit and then put it back. Try not to be noticed.
Individuals who can train you into that. And the okay. So, yeah, you can most definitely do it. And how it's going to work is you sort of begin to... sort of like buddy up with a couple of the crew members. And they introduce you into a game that they call Pinch Pocket. And what it is it's a bit of a contest with amongst the crew members to steal a specific trinket off of whoever's holding it and to maintain ownership of that trinket the longest. And then okay. at the end of the month, whoever was able to hold on to that trinket the longest wins like a small pool.
Yeah, she's totally down for that.
Okay.
It's like a fun game, actually.
And do you have proficiency in sleight of hand already? Or
no.
Okay. So this is, I believe, a 32 clock is what it is for learning a new 35. Skill.
35.
Yeah, a 35 clock.
Yeah.
35. Yeah.
Yep. So I will work on that during these 3 days.
All right. So with that, you can give me 3d6 rolls. And just
it's
like,
dice like me.
Read them off one by one.
All right. So the first one was a 2.
Okay. So that's one. That's one tick.
Okay. The next one was a 4.
That's 2 ticks.
And the last one was a 3.
That's 2 ticks as well.
Awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, Shara is disqualified from that game because she's got the little crab in the bag of holding.
Yeah. No one tell Shara about the game.
Little did you know, Jenka invented the game.
Probably. I mean, she probably got bored of playing it. Just kidding.
So like, I'm too good. I'm just going to move on.
Alrighty. Anyone else?
Actually, on that theme, I was hoping to possibly upgrade or start the clock to upgrade my athletics.
Definitely a thing you can do.
Because I'm currently proficient.
Okay. Working on a ship, you can definitely, you know, upgrade that. Definitely upgrade that athletics.
Athletics and acrobatics are fairly easy to do when you're playing with rigging around.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So are you going to dedicate the 3 days to training that up? Okay. So a proficiency is it 70 or 72? Because it was. I think it was double. Or expertise,
I think. It was 70. Yes. I can't remember.
I thought it was actually 75.
I know the 75
I
was doing for the
well.
Feet. But I thought it was different for... I don't know.
Well, let's call it 75 for right now.
I thought expertise was 75.
Yeah,
I have to switch.
Let's call it 75 for expertise right now, and then we can go back and... look through it later on.
And you said 75?
75.
Okay.
Yeah, we do this often enough. You think we just keep this rule somewhere where all of us can look it up?
You think we would have we would have a homebrew rules section on the on the Discord or something like that, but
yeah.
Fox is like
or just pin the message.
I mean, I just keep all this stuff on my character sheets, so I just look at my character sheets, but
I don't have
any of that going on Shara.
3d6.
Yeah, I do too, my character sheets.
If you are, hello, Evie, climbing the wall practicing your athletic. Yeah, it, for every day you d6, so if you're going to do all three, it's 3d6.
Alright, that is a 5, 5, and a 2.
5, 5, and a 2, so that is 3, 3, and 1.
Perfect.
And I'm thinking of introducing an explosive rule to this. So that if you roll a 6 on it, you can roll again.
I'm down with that.
Yeah, that's kind of cool idea.
Because I'm thinking about it, and you know, 35 and 75 are, you know, bit of a numbers to get up there, so.
They are, but I mean, these are also pretty major things, mm-hmm. right?
True. Mm-hmm. But it would only be one explosion. Like, it can't constantly explode, so. On those rolls that you would hit that 6, you can roll again, and you would get a maximum of 6 points from that roll.
You had a day of inspiration.
Cool, I like that.
Yeah, you had an inspired day of training.
Yeah, you did so well that you did a little better.
For all those opposite days when you roll a 1 and you're just like,
you remembered to like take your pre-workout before doing all the hard activities. Alrighty. Anyone else doing any skill rolls or wanting to take care of anything for the 3 days?
I mean, I'm gonna be at the helm, and we had discussed that counts towards my large vessel sailing.
It does.
Expertise. But I'll roll that when I actually do the rolls for the helm.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, if that's
That's the case,
go ahead.
Jenka's gonna work on her carpentry proficiency for the last 2 days.
Okay, so if you're gonna do the last 2 days, then give me 2d6.
Oh, that is a d8. Nope. Well, I shit you not, I got a 6 for one of them. 6 and a 5.
6 and a 5, so that is 3, and then go ahead and give me... So right now you've got a total of 6, go ahead and give me another d6 roll here.
4.
4? So that's an additional 2 points on top of that.
Just over halfway there. Cool. Thank you.
Yep. All right, so for the last 2 days of this journey, Shara, if you can give me your roles for piloting the ship. And since Pearl is up there doing her thing, you can get the little bonuses from that too.
Okay, I will do do it one day at a time. It's not great, but not terrible. 17 on the first one.
You're still good.
Next one's much better with a dirty 20.
Okay, so as you're still going through from full sails, the ship is only going to take about 10 points of damage to the hull, just because of the just the stress that you're putting on the ship at the moment, but not too much.
Okay,
now can that be repaired on going?
Yeah, it's like it's minuscule.
Jenka's probably doing it.
Yeah, it's like since Jenka's doing her carpentry thing, it's, you know, any wear and tear that can be repaired while at sea, yeah, it can be that can be taken care of. Like 10 points of damage is like minor hull damage. It's not like, you know, you've taken any sort of like hull breach or anything like that. So something that would require you go to a dry dock in order to patch up.
Normal wear and tear for pushing it to its limits.
Yep. All right. So if you want to give me those 2d6,
That is a 5 and a 1.
5 and a 1. So that is a total of 4. All right. So what we're going to do is we are going to take a quick break here so we can get up, stretch our legs, freshen up our drinks, all that fun stuff. And when we come back, the ship will be coming into port at the Parsnip Scrapyard. But stick with us, everyone. We will be right back.
There's other
people. All right.
See their kids. There's all sorts of
other and things. We are back.
Oh, hello.
Diesel shot. Thank you for that raid.
Oh, nice. Right on time.
We seem to have a tradition going on right now to where we get raided as we go on breaks.
While we're on break.
But Diesel shot. Thank you very much for that raid. Everyone, welcome on in. And yeah, so as we resume tonight's episode, the ship begins to pull in once again to the little rickety dock of the Parsnip family scrapyard. The doors to the scrapyard are completely wide open by the time you come in. The scrapyard is open for business. Doesn't look like there's too much foot traffic or boat traffic or whatever you want to call it at this moment. Kind of a good sign that the incident of Echo Bay may have not yet reached Tidelight or any of the surrounding area. Though there seems to be a singular gentleman kind of waiting at the end of the dock. Where it meets the land, covered in like this very large, like brownish robe, little white flecks of what looked to be bird dung all over it, carrying a large staff with like this giant hooded cage. The sounds of multiple birds inside clambering about and chirping can be heard from it.
Bryant, I think there's someone here to see you, matey.
Rory kind of walks by and she pats you on the shoulder. She's like, no, that one is for me. That's the contact I was telling you about.
Oh.
Don't worry, he's friendly. A little kooky at times. Prefers birds over people, but nothing that you have to worry about. She kind of just excuses herself as she walks down the gangplank, and they begin to converse to one another, leaving the rest of you up on the dock, as just the surge of people come rushing off of the ship from coming up from the underside of the deck, and as soon as they've been told that they made landfall, they're all clambering off onto the dry land.
When we arrive and step off of the ship, do we smell any food coming from Mama Plum's kitchen?
Of course you do. This is Mama Plum we are talking about. It already sounds like she has something delicious in store for breakfast.
I know we've got some important things to talk about and business to do, but if I smell food coming from that kitchen, I'm going straight for it.
And as you start coming down the dock, the youngest of her children, the twins Pitter and Patter, sort of begin meeting everybody and like sort of like guiding them into the scrapyard towards the communal area where Plum's kitchen is at. The looks on everyone's faces is all the same, very telling that they're starving, and whatever Plum is cooking up today smells absolutely amazing.
Well, I'm freaking hungry, so I'm going.
Okay.
I mean, if there's delicious smelling food, I'm gonna follow that smell.
Yeah.
So, as he enters and gets a good huff of the smell that's coming from the kitchen, I'm assuming here, Cannonball's gonna, again, like I said, take that deep, deep huff here, and it's gonna go a little like,
well, it looks like the apprentice still has a thing or two to learn from the master.
He says, laughing, obviously, here. Well, not at Bryant, but just, you know, again, as Bryant, he assumes anyway that Bryant learned how to cook from Mama Plum
here. Yeah. He kind of like shakes his head and is like, that's an unfair comparison. That's like comparing a priest to their god.
Hey, I have a thing or two to learn from old Hydra too. No shame in that, matey. Especially when it be coming to mayhem and destruction.
He shakes his head and just begins to like descend down to the gang, down to the gangplank and into the scrapyard itself. And Echo, I believe this is your first time here.
It is.
So, as you walk into this scrapyard, you notice that the sign on this large sheet metal door is a slogan that says, "One person's trash is a possum's treasure." And you can see a little bit a ways these two bipedal possum creatures sort of running back and forth along the line of people coming into the scrapyard. One of them is jet black and the other one is like pristine white, just like the opposites of one another. But the way that they move and they seem to act around them kind of gives away that they're twins. And as you're passing by, you see another possum standing up on a on just like a mound of scrap, dressed in like this very do-it-yourself made looking captain's uniform, like a long flowing captain's jacket and the tricorn hat with a very bright plumed feather inside of it, all of it a little bit too big for her, and like a human-like saber on her hip, and she's kind of standing there like looking at everybody with her arms folded, just like a little like trying to hide a grin on her face but failing to do so.
But
what?
Just as we're walking, I'm just going to nudge Brian a little bit, be like, I see the family resemblance.
Oh, ha ha.
No, matey, don't let her badger you into doing these things. Don't let her badger you like that.
And he kind of, like, waves to, Penelope, who's up on the scrap mound at the moment. And as you enter on in, you can see that most of the, I'm not gonna say most, but quite a few of the, family isn't there. You don't see Pyro manning his barbecue. There doesn't seem to be any sort of, smell of meat in that, fireball juice that he, marinates it in. Pierce and Piccolo are also not there. The only ones that you seem to see were Penelope, and then Pitter and Patter, and then Persimmon is, of course, helping with the cooking in Plum's kitchen.
Is Jenka getting off the boat?
She already said that when she smelled food, she was
going. Oh, okay, because Pearl would probably, as she did with Rory, kind of be sticking close to Jenka, and she probably would tug on your coat when she sees Penelope and say, "This reminds me, I think you're going to need a new hat."
Oh, shit. Hats mess up my hair. We're not going to talk about the hat.
There's just a lot Jenka doesn't want to talk about, isn't there?
Well, you don't have to necessarily wear the hat. But...
mean metaphorical hat?
No, I was looking at Penelope's hat and just sort of thinking that, remembering or looking at Rory's hat, and it's sort of a captain thing. For the crew, you know.
I know plenty of captains that don't wear those hats. Fine, maybe I'll think about it.
So,
we'll see.
As you all finally make it into this, into like the common area, there is already a bunch of people sitting down anywhere they can find a spot. All of them have like heaping plates of food. And it looks like today that, Plum has made a variety of different style of pancakes, ranging from just like your basic, you know, everyday pancake to some that have like chocolate chips in them. Others seem to almost seem like they have like flecks of confetti inside of them. There is like fresh fruit and multiple syrups that you can help yourselves to, like a very large mound of bacon, scrambled eggs, and then of course, because you know it can't be breakfast without it, a very large helping of biscuits and gravy. And like, even with the amount of people who are eating the food, both Persimmon and Plum are able to keep up with the food getting out there. There's definitely enough for anybody to come back for seconds and thirds.
Mind if I do?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Ken involves eating like a man who hasn't eaten in 3 days, and that's probably because I forgot to roleplay him actually eating in for the last few sessions, but you know, we'll just say he's eating like a man who hasn't eaten in 3 days.
Yeah, I'm probably eating as well, probably 2 or 3 helpings, and then refilling coffee along with it, and every hot coffee becomes an Irish coffee. I'll add a little rum to the maple syrup on the pancakes, you know. Whenever there's an opportunity to add rum, I'm adding rum.
Surprisingly enough, one of the syrups already has rum inside of it.
Oh, perfect. Look at Bright. We need some of this on the ship.
Oh yeah, anything you want on the ship, I most definitely do. I can do. Mama Plum's given me a copy of her cookbook, so. Any special requests that you need, I am happy to fulfill.
Oh my god, yes. Rum syrup, need that.
And Plum kind of looks over to Echo and dusts her, like, flower-covered hands on her apron. She comes out, and she's just this very, like, rotund, happy-looking mama possum, and like a bright red apron, and just like a little frilled bonnet. She comes out and she looks up at you. I see you found new friends, Bryant. And he kind of like chokes back a piece of fruit, and he's like, sorry, Mama, I forgot my manners. Echo, Mama Plum, Mama Plum, Echo.
I put a bite in my mouth and go, this is delicious.
She gives you like a very toothy grin. She's like, oh, I love it when Bryant brings home friends who, have a healthy appetite. Well, help yourself, dear. Anything you see here, you want to eat it, go right ahead.
Thank you very much. This is a good meal.
Don't mind if I do.
She smiles. She's like, I'm just happy that I got a forewarning that we were going to have so many mouths to feed, or I would have been off guard and, well, would have to cook overtime.
Putting together a feast like this has to take a lot, because this is
this is just what we would do for a small party or family gathering when the in-laws decide to come in from the Feywild.
Well, if you have anything else that's been mixed with the rum, point me towards it, because that is my favorite.
She kind of smiles. She's like, I'll get you a batch of rum cookies.
Yes. That sounds delicious. I'm going to go back to just shoveling food in my mouth about as fast as I can.
And just like every one of Mama Plum's meals comes with a little boost. So
nerd.
Because this is a very hearty, almost lumberjack-like breakfast, everybody here is going to get 20 temporary HP.
Wow.
And for the next 24 hours, any strength-based rolls, skill rolls, or anything like that will be made with advantage.
So that's 24?
Yeah. 20.
Oh, 20, I'm sorry. 20
temp HP, and then any strength-based checks or just straight-up strength rolls will be made with advantage. And as
love it,
things sort of like begin to quote unquote wind down, and people seem to be in a very calmer state of mind after getting a very much needed meal. Mama Plum kind of comes out of the kitchen with her own plate of food and takes a seat next to a majority of you. So I assume once, you've gotten what you needed and digested your food, you're going to head out to the jungles.
Why would we do that?
Seems to be the plan.
Well, that was the information I was given. I was told to make sure that you had a very hearty meal because you had a long journey ahead of you.
Did I miss a meeting or something? Why are we going into the jungles?
It was just a note that I was given. The some of my boys went out earlier today. They said that they saw some strange things in the sky that they needed to investigate. So they packed up the gear and they headed on out. Depending on how long you stay, you may catch up to them within a day or so. If what the letter was, the letter that was delivered is telling the truth and you are heading into the jungles to experience, to investigate the oddities that had been happening.
Who sent you this letter?
I wish I knew. It was just sitting in the family mailbox. Addressed to me, no signature or anything. Very nice handwriting. The cardstock wasn't too bad either. But it said that I should prepare as we would be having return guests and a few extra mouths to feed.
Is Rory here with us at the moment, or is she off somewhere?
Rory has come in and she's sat down and she's gotten her food, and she seems to have sort of a hesitant look on her face.
I'll kind of look over at her then. Did you send a letter in advance to our coming here?
Not to Mama Plum, no.
Brian, did you send a letter?
He kind of like shrugs, like, how would I send a letter out at sea?
I don't know how you do most of the things you do.
Fair, but no, it wasn't me.
I mean, nobody else knew that we were here previously or that we were even on our way, right?
He kind of looks around and is like, your guess is good as mine. Like, none of the crew has any means to deliver letters over the water.
Rory, is this the work of one of the Silver Tongues?
She kind of shakes her head, like, no, the only person I contacted was Roberts, and, well, he met us here, so I don't know why he would have to deliver a letter when he could have just delivered it by, well, delivered it with his voice to Mama Plum. Besides, he tends to deliver things by bird and not in mailboxes.
So somebody knows what we're up to, knows where we've been and where we're going, and has planned accordingly. This has got trap written all over it, right? I'm not the only one thinking that.
Well, it definitely sounds fishy, matey.
That it ties to a map that you had, Shara. None of this is looking good.
Yeah, Mama Plum, you said you sent some of your kids out already,
well,
right?
I didn't send them, but, you know,
but
I can't...
chose to go.
Yes, Pierce, Pyro, and Piccolo set out to investigate it. Just before you showed up, maybe about an hour or so, there were a couple random lightning strikes. Your day. Just storming down into what we assume is the far jungles.
Let me guess, the jungles near, like, the west coast of the island?
And that's what my boys assumed. Unless they come back and tell us anything different. Knowing them, they're not going to go fully there. They're just getting closer to do a bit of a study before coming back.
Yeah, they should definitely be keeping their distance.
Those boys are seasoned adventurers. They can handle themselves.
Oh, hey, wait, this letter. Did it come in an envelope? And do you still have it?
Oh, yes. Give me a moment. She jumps down and waddles on back into the kitchen. He comes back and places down a very beautifully crafted white envelope with the name Plum written across it.
I'm going to pull the map out of my bag and pull it out of the envelope that it was in.
Mm-hmm.
Do the two bear any resemblance to each other?
Aside from being made of some form of paper, no. The one that you pull the map out of it, it's sort of worn, bit of yellow across the envelope, and it's definitely seen some use. This envelope looks fresh.
Okay, well, that's maybe a good thing. They weren't delivered by the same creature. Hopefully. I think it's probably time that we tell Mama Plum about everything that happened in Echo Bay.
Oh, were there goings on in Echo Bay?
You could say that.
And unless anybody from the group stops me, I'll give her the full rundown of everything that happened when we were there. Quiet enough so that the, you know, survivors don't really hear me talking about it. We don't need to bring that up with them at the moment. But just telling her everything.
And she sits there and she, you know, as she's eating her food and listening to everything you say, and she kind of dabs a napkin at her mouth. My goodness, it seems like you've had a bit of an adventure with the short time that you've been away from us.
It's been something.
It honestly sounds like one of those adventures from one of my favorite novels.
Well, it's an adventure that's still going on. We're not really sure what's happening, who's pulling the strings. We don't know what this map that was left with us leads to. We don't really know anything.
Can I see the map?
The map could be enchanted and tracking us.
I will pull out the map and unfold it.
She like slide it over. Quickly takes the map from you, and she just has a very interested look on her face. She's like, "Oh, I just love a mystery." Just sets the map down and pulls out just like a little monocle and hooks it into her eye and starts looking at it. Well, it's not enchanted. Whoever wrote on this map has horrible penmanship.
So, Mama Plum, when you said it reminds you of one of your adventure novels, a specific adventure novel or just a grand adventure generally?
Just a grand adventure, though. Oh,
okay.
Though I don't see any sea captain with rippling muscles amongst you, but you know, real life is normally different than fantasy. She like looks back down to the map and
Jenka resists the urge to show her abs. I think we just have to give Shara a hat.
She's like,
you can fill the role.
Cannonball just tightens his coat a little tighter.
I know exactly where this is at. It's a bit of a pain to get through, I'll give you that. So if you do plan on setting out there, I highly suggest equipping yourselves for a bit of a trek. It's a bit overgrown in that area. Most people tend to stay away from that side of the shore. Superstitions and all.
Do you know if there's anything over there?
I haven't been there completely through it, but there's supposed to be some sort of abandoned village near the jungle's edge, closest to the west side of the shore. Been abandoned for quite some time now, but that hasn't stopped people from trying to explore it anyway.
So what kind of superstitions?
Oh, you know, the basic sea superstitions. It's haunted, it's taken over by Sahagin cultists, it's actually a front for a ancient demonic organization bent on enslaving all of Tamir. You know, just wild stories that sailors come up with to pass the time.
When all stories have a kernel of truth behind them.
When Pearl hears the part about cultists taking over, her ears perk up a bit. But and people come back.
Oh yes. Oh, I'm sorry if I made it sound like they didn't. No, they do come back, though very few reach the town. As I said, it gets a bit of a trek trying to cut through that jungle at times. And well, the wildlife don't necessarily take kindly to people just trying to trounce on through.
Did this abandoned village have a name?
Oh, I'm sure it did at some point. But it escapes me.
So it's old enough to have been forgotten, then.
Oh, there are small abandoned towns, you know, freckled across all of Tamir. That's nothing new. Most of the time it's because they were abandoned because they found a better area with better resources to call home. I don't think I've ever heard of anything bad ever happening to one of these towns as to why they're abandoned. You know, fires and whatnot, yes, but curses or anything like that, not really.
This one's pretty close to the coast. It's possible they all went mad.
That is one of the rumors, but I can't say for sure if that's true or not.
What would be the distance approximately from Tidelight to that village?
Tidelight to that village, distance wise, that's about probably a good week's travel.
Okay.
Distance wise.
Okay.
That's not counting the time that you would have to be going through the jungle. As like, I know like the map, like it, the islands look small, but they are large land masses.
Yeah, I was just speculating as to whether with Pearl having spent time in, you know, in the woods and so on as a child, if she would, you know, if she would have ventured that far or would have, I'm trying to think if that's something she would have knowledge of and how, like, but I think that would have to be a history role, wouldn't it? To know if she knows more.
Pearl wouldn't necessarily know about those jungles, as even as a child she was warned to keep away from there. Most of your forest excursions and whatnot have happened in the southern forests near Tidelight.
Okay, and it's not like it's not something that would be sort of taught in school, that this kind of history or anything.
No, it's
okay.
It's
all right.
Like, again, a lot of superstition surrounds that side of the island, so most of the time any information you get from it is just half-hearted hearsay.
So just to clarify then, on the east side of the island, obviously there's the scrapyard and there's Tidelight. Are there other, like, are there more smaller towns on
yes.
that eastern side then?
There are towns like freckled all about Tamir, and once we get like the larger map set up for that, you'll see that there are various like communities that have been formed that reside outside of Tidelight.
Any inland? Like if we were going, say, from Tidelight to that jungle, are there any towns on the way?
Yeah, there are definitely towns that are inland. There are some that, like, reside in the plains, and there are others that reside in, like, the forests themselves. But in regards to what exactly is in the jungle itself is sort of a mystery. There's, like, you've caught rumors of like strange beasts and large creatures and everything calling that like the jungle home, but aside from that, like, one little town right there on the edge, there doesn't seem to be any sort of notation as to any sort of humanoid civilization inside the jungle itself.
So, I don't suppose you have some provisions that we can stock up on for this long trek.
Well, of course, dear.
As well as any additional supplies we may need.
Of course, I wouldn't let family go out and trek about unprepared. Like,
Jenka looks uncomfortable for a moment before she says, "I appreciate it."
He goes, "Anything you need." Let me see if I have the right one. She's like, "Anything that you need, speak to Persimmon and she'll get you situated if we have it."
Will do. Thank you.
Is Pyro one of the ones that have ventured out?
Yes.
Are they okay?
It's Pierce, Piccolo, and Pyro are the ones that set out. So pretty much the warrior, the bard, and the artificer of the group.
a good party.
Yeah.
So, Captain, does that He's mean that party, you're actually. Thinking of going into the jungle?
Jenka munches on some biscuits and gravy. Not realizing you're talking to her.
Jenka? Yeah. Captain Jenka. We're on land. You're captain, I think. Are we heading into the jungle then?
Whether it is a trap or not, I feel like if we just sweep this under the rug, it's just going to come back to bite us in the ass. So the more we learn about this devil, the better. Especially since it sounds like it has it out for us. The more information we have, the better. So I think it might be a good idea to trek into the jungle. Or go back to town and find information until, you know, we can go in. But I doubt other people have the information we need.
Is Bryant around at this point?
Oh, yeah, Bryant is...
Okay, so I'm going to ask Bryant. So, Bryant, given we originally left Tidelight to kind of wait till things cooled down, do you think it's cooled down enough we could go back to Tidelight at this point, or we need to give it a little more time?
Honestly, I would suggest giving it a little more time. It's only been a little over a week since we've been gone. I don't know how long... The acquisition side of Ravon's company keeps records, but I can guarantee they're keeping an eye out for us. What I can do is, we're on land. I can shoot a letter over to my sister, see if anything is blown over for us with the incident of the Ravon ship being sunk out at sea. And, them calling the portion of the ships that they had in Echo Bay out to look for those responsible. We may have been forgotten.
It's worth checking.
How long does it take for that to happen, though?
Well, we're on land, a bird can probably get the tide light in a couple days. Maybe a day.
I mean, if we just need information out of the town, we could always send in part of the crew or myself, people who weren't chased out.
Rory sort of looks at everyone. She's like, I'm headed on into Tidelight myself to establish official contact with my group. So I can take a look and shoot information back to the rest of you. Oh, that reminds me. And she sort of reaches underneath the table and places like this strange looking bird cage on top, and there's like this strange carved wooden macaw sort of sitting inside. This is how we will communicate with each other from here on in. Just write what you need.
About to ask, actually.
Just write anything you need down, or any information, or if you just want to say hi, and write it down, fold up the paper, open the macaw's mouth, put the parchment in, close it, and then whisper the name of the person you want it delivered to.
And it will find us even within the depths of the jungle.
As long as you have the cage.
How big is this cage?
It's about a decent size of a bird cage. It's not great, but
it's like a big ass bird cage.
It's not something that Pearl could attach to her staff or something, so that
you could attach it to your staff. So it's getting like if you were to attach it to the staff, you'd have to remove it before using it as a weapon.
Yeah, no.
Well, we could see if we can get it enchanted and shrink it down so it's a little bit more travel worthy. But the good news is, technically, I mean, we could test it out. We do have a bag that can store a lot of items in the meantime.
Yeah. That would be better.
So we have ways. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. It'll be something. And I'm actually going to keep this little item with me. Holy shit, I forgot what it was called. The decahedron.
Oh, okay.
Which, by the way, is an egg.
I
plan to take good care of it. Because it's an odd creature of great rarity. And what's cooler and more intimidating than a captain and a parrot, than a captain and a drake? Just saying.
And as you say that, you see a bit of regret on Rory's face that he pretty much gave away the egg.
So, Jenka, are you going to take it into the jungle or leave it here for safekeeping while we're gone?
No, I'm going to keep it here for safekeeping. If it was already hatched, maybe it would be a different story. But no, I'm going to keep it here and have someone take care of it, or at least look into it. In the meantime,
Mama Plum pipes up. She's like, I would be more than happy to look after your child.
As a mother of many, I trust you completely.
It will be in safe hands. Tell me, what kind of drake is it?
It's a paper drake.
Oh. Well, I'm keeping it away from my books, then.
Yeah, I was gonna say, if it hatches before then, keep it away from maps and books and paper. Unless it's like blank paper, you know, it may want a color, but, you know, just anything else that's already filled.
Well, I will make sure if it hatches that it's fed and entertained. And I will do my best to keep it away from any of my books.
So, Rory, if we feed the macaw a note, how long does it take for the information to be digested and returned to us?
Well, it all depends on both parties. See, it's a two-way system. As the person that has the other macaw would need to be near the cage to know they have a message. Think of it sort of as a sort of mailbox. Parcels will be delivered, but it's all up to you to pick them up. I don't know the exact...
Stay a mail, but with macaw. Got it.
I don't know the exact time that it would take to deliver a message. I've only used these a couple times. But I tend to get responses back from my contacts within a day or two.
Good to know.
Guess we can test it out sometime, maybe.
So, Captain.
So how are you getting back then?
Oh, sorry, go ahead.
I was just gonna ask, when are we setting out to the jungle? Today, tomorrow? Well,
I don't know about you, but I'm a little low on supplies when it comes to a by land journey. So we can see what we have in stock and see what we can collect. And I don't know about you, but I think I might want to get some more rope for one.
Does anybody have a more detailed map of the area between here and there? There's got to be like a river or something that I can just travel on, because traveling through the jungle on foot for days at a time, it sounds like just the worst thing to me. If I could swim there, that would be great.
Never gone on a hike before?
I've gone on hikes, you know, a day or two at most.
That there aren't many natural water lakes that are on the inland of Termir. There are wells where towns have been established outside of Tidelight that have their own water supply, but not necessarily anything like as like a river or a stream or anything like that.
How much rope you looking for, Jinka? I got about 100 feet on me.
Let's see here.
I have 50.
Where's my rope? Yeah, I just have the bare minimum on rope, so yeah, I was thinking 100 just to be safe.
I've also got some got 60 feet of rope, but there is a grappling hook on one end, and I tied it on there like 2 years ago, and the knot is so tight I can't get it off anymore.
That could be useful.
And grappling hooks are useful.
Why have you never untied the knots?
Well, I've tried, but I tied it so tight on there. I can't undo it.
All right, grappling hook it is.
Who would have thought Char would be the first to tie the knot?
I mean, we probably need
this. Is why you're not captain.
Tents? Something to camp in if we're going to be gone for longer than a day? Not about you, but I don't really care around camping supplies because I prefer Char to be at sea.
You don't? Am I the only one here that's actually gone out, like, not on sea? And I don't mean the city, I don't mean a town, I mean like land.
Only when the monastery forced me to.
This is why ye, as your first act as captain, are sending us out to land and not to sea.
Yeah, I mean, I've gone out on excursions plenty, but you know, they were planned. You know, I could get supplies beforehand. We kind of left the city in a hurry. I don't have camping supplies that I just carry around with me all the time.
Oh shit, I forgot I have a bag of holding.
I mean, when I was younger, I spent a lot of time in the woods, and I just, because I'm always sort of prepared for the worst, I do have basic things with me, but no tents. A tent would be a big plus, I think. One or two tents, maybe.
Maybe like an extra large tent for me.
Let's get one of those really big tents.
Yeah, okay, first things first. let's just get the basic shit first then, I guess. Let's get food, stuff for like tents and sleeping bags. I've got stuff to help make fire.
I mean, you need bedrolls on a ship too, because you know, sleeping in those cots, not very warm.
Mama Plum smiles, she's like, I hear what all of you are saying, and I'll have Persimmon put together a little camping package for all of you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. I didn't realize how underprepared everyone else seemed to be.
You know, if you don't have the camping supplies to spare, you know, we don't have to go.
Oh,
right.
Don't worry, dear.
Going, Shara.
We have quite a few tents and sleeping arrangements and camping supplies. We do make the most out of everything that we scavenge from the ships. So you're gonna
need
water
skins as well.
Water skins, yes, yes. We can get all that.
Am I the only person who was on a ship who was prepared for a shipwreck?
To be fair, probably. Most of my stuff went down with the ship that I was on.
That's true.
Before I got on our ship, I was at work. I don't carry that stuff around with me at work.
Yeah,
same here. To be fair,
you got a bunch of like city dwellers in this group.
Jenka's just like shaking her head, like, God.
I like to stay on ships, not the land, so I don't carry a tent. You don't typically need a tent when you're on deck.
When I'm going on a ship, I prepare for that. When I'm going out, you know, to land, I prepare for that. When I'm going to work, I don't bring camping supplies.
I'd be kind of odd if you did.
If I may, in the interest of crew morale, belittling your crew for not being prepared for something they're obviously not hired to do may not be the best way to ingratiate yourself to them. Fair warning.
Noted. What the hell, everyone? What the hell?
So, Jacob, you're telling me you walk around with a tent everywhere. You just carry a giant tent with you all the time. It's a little weird.
All right.
I carry everything I own with me at all times.
That's a little weird and paranoid.
I have reasons. Yes, Captain. You're right. This was before my bag of holding. I travel light. Simple backpack.
And a giant tent.
One-person tent because, you know, alone. No, I travel alone. One-person tent. I don't share.
Look, I got my bedroll for sleeping in the cot. I got my water skin because when you're on a ship, you still need water skins.
Clearly, Captain.
Carry a tent.
If you'd be so kind. And I'm sure I speak for a lot of us here. What the hell is a ship crew going to do in the jungle? I mean, don't get me wrong. I've listened to the conversation. I just simply fail to see our motivation for doing such a thing. Be there treasures, temple, a reason for us to go where, well, one with a sea foot is not really meant to go. Or sea legs. Yeah, sea legs, sorry, English. Yeah, one with sea legs is not meant to go.
Did you not hear the warning from the creature when it was fed into Rory's head? This thing is not going to really let us go that easily. And I would like to learn more about my enemy than have it just sneak up on me unexpected.
So you want to run straight into a temple that's obviously associated with the darn thing. Like the last temple was not exactly, pardon me language, a good idea.
I didn't walk through the door.
But yet, she has no idea what she's getting herself into.
Well, to be fair, you don't even know that.
Like I knew what was going to happen.
You don't know that whatever is over there is even associated with this thing. This was a whispered man, whispered one.
Whispered thing.
I mean, that town's been there forever.
I'm merely looking for information, not to just throw myself into the jaws of danger.
Well, here's what I'm trying to say, Matey. If it is associated with this darn thing, it's potentially dangerous. If it's not associated with that thing, there won't be any information about this thing. Ergo, the way I see it, we're either headed into danger.
Okay.
So, mind question,
so we're dealing
Matey.
With a devil. Mm-hmm.
Is what's the hazard pay looking like under Captain Jenka?
We're dealing with a devil that has now been freed, that was the information broker between hags and the hells. Don't think that's not going to affect people, and by people I mean us, because we're the ones that did this shit.
So, when she mentions the hags and she asks whether or not it's going to affect people, at this point, Cannonball, his face, like, darkens, and you can see that his fists are balled to the point of the knuckles being white. He's going to get right up in Jenka's face. And he's gonna say, I think firsthand, out of everyone here, there's not a lot of people who can say they've seen what being affected by those disgusting creatures can do to you.
Jenka doesn't even bat an eye, looking straight back, not looking intimidated at all, as she's like, same here. Just now, waits for him to respond.
Now I just see that meme image of the both people hating hags and the hands clasped together.
Pretty much
from a Predator, the Predator scene.
Predator, there we go. Yeah. Except which one is Jenka talking about? Ooh.
Pancakes, watch this play out.
Well, Mama Plum chimes. He's like, oh, not all hags are bad. Some of them are actually very helpful.
I'm not talking about hags.
Well, I be talking about hags. And the last captain I served under did not listen to caution when I said not to trifle with the hags' belongings. I'm just simply hoping that this one won't trifle with devil and devilry against mine own warnings.
Well, unfortunately, on that front, I think that the devils have trifled with us.
You know what?
Basically, he kind of stone.
He deflates a little bit. You know what, matey?
You're the captain. I'll just collect my hazard pay at the end of the day.
And on that note, Cannonball will just back off and resume eating.
Anyone else?
I mean, I already said I don't want to do this, but an order is an order. Right. Also, I do want to make sure that the other Mama Plum's children are okay.
Oh, you don't have to worry about them, dear.
Especially
they took the rabble rouser or the rabble rouser outs. They're well protected.
What?
Yes.
What did they take?
The rabble rouser. It's one of Pyro's creations. She kind of points over to like where the like Pyro's section of the scrapyard is at, and you notice that there are like two very deep and freshly made tread marks in the ground.
Pyro build a tank?
Are you telling me he has a land ship of sorts?
Oh, that's my boy. Always looking to build things and blow things up.
This rabble rouser. How big is it? Like, I see the tracks, but do they all fit in it? Do they ride on it?
Oh, we can all fit in it. It's very spacious.
I'm sure this isn't one of Tickle's kids. Are you sure about this? This wasn't one of her kids?
No.
Bad. Okay.
Plum is originally from the Feywild. He is a Fey creature.
I know Tickle's horn meter is not going to stop her from doing something with another possum. Just saying. She did a rat, she could do a possum. Just saying. All the Mervin family.
If we could catch up with them.
All right, so what does anyone else suggest then?
Well, if we could catch up with them, maybe we could ride with them.
That sounds a lot better than walking through the jungle. How long ago did they set out?
Earlier today.
An hour.
Oh. So we totally probably could catch up with them.
Yeah, I mean, we just follow the massive tracks, right?
Hmm. Yeah, you can tell that while Pyro may have made a giant machine, he did not take into account the depth that the treads were going to tear into the earth.
No fucks given.
You said it was Persimmon we could talk to if we wanted some supplies. I don't necessarily need it for the trip, but for some stuff for the ship when we get back would be nice.
Oh, Bryant pipes up. He's like, I will make sure that we have everything taken care of for the ship. Unless you need
for my own personal stuff for the ship.
Personal stuff, yeah. Then, yeah. Percy's the one to talk to then.
Well, Captain, when are we heading out?
Well, if we want to catch up to them, I guess as soon as possible. Otherwise, they'll gain distance on us.
Well, we do have a very good breakfast to work off.
Should we just go grab some camping gears from Percy and then head out?
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, I think the sooner the better to try and catch up with them. Besides, I've got a proposition for Pyro.
She, sort of looks over at Echo. It's like, oh, before you go, do you feel free to check the basement for anything you may want?
Just leave the painting on the floor.
Yeah, don't pick up the painting.
Okay.
Oh, you don't have to worry about that. We moved it.
Oh, that's good.
And now overlooks a very tranquil lake.
I don't think I want to know.
Just don't go near the painting.
Or got it. Or don't go through it.
That too.
I usually don't make a habit of trying to enter paintings.
Neither do I.
Just things come out and attack.
Yeah.
Well, Kevin, if we had enough time, I'll run down there. Sounds like I have some sort of supplies down there. Okay. I'll more head on off to the basement then.
Okay.
Probably better.
And as you head down into the basement, it is definitely an interesting hodgepodge of items that have been strewn about the table, like in various areas of like this small alcove that is almost filled to the brim with like these various weapons and armor and jewelry pieces and miscellaneous objects.
So I'm gonna start picking through objects, looking for anything that might catch my eye. So anything related to drinking, brewing, anything. I don't wear armor, I don't wear weapons, so really wouldn't spend much on them, other than, you know, I punch things.
Yeah, monk bullshit, I gotcha.
Monk bullshit, yep.
Alright, so go ahead and give me an investigation roll, since you're looking for, like, drinking utensils.
I mean, that's where her primary focus will always be. Always. Investigation is going to be a 13.
13. So you're going through and you sort of dip off into like an alcove off to the left, as you see this, trying to, it's sort of a helm, but it's more of like one of those sparring helmets that people wear in boxing to like protect their ears and whatnot. Mm-hmm. It's just like this small, like just a small face harness, I guess you would call it. But on the sides of the harness, right to the side, you can see that there are two iron flasks that have been built, that are resting into these two built-in pockets. And then there's just like this small set of tubing that runs out and then comes together into a singular straw.
It looks awesome. I'm definitely checking that out. More shake it real fast. Does it sound like there's any liquid in it?
It sounds like both of these, both of them are full.
Let's just ask and be tried out now. And while my character does have some wisdom to her, she, it tends to go out the window when it comes to drinking, so. She's gonna go ahead and put that on and take a sip just to see what it is.
Alright, so you put it on and you take a sip, and it is, it hits you, and it hits you good. It is like just like probably the best whiskey you have like ever tasted. There's just like a nice smooth burn that goes down with it, and you feel just like this warmth building inside of you. Can you roll me a d6?
That would be a 6.
A 6? And all of a sudden you just feel this unbridled rage just like tear through your body for a brief moment as you look around and there is literally nobody to punch. And so you sort of like instantly snap out of it.
Hmm. I'm taking this with me. This seems like fun.
So
this seems like fun.
What this does is this alcohol dispensive unit, as you would call it, has different outcomes based on what you roll at a D6. On a 6, you enter into the equivalent of a barbarian's rage.
That's awesome.
Gaining all of the effects of said barbarian's rage.
This is going to be fun to figure out what it does. All right. Well, I'm excited about this, so she's just going to head on out with her new fancy-looking headgear.
Looking like
not
she's
carrying it, might.
Looking like she's going to a boxing event or something like that.
Not caring if she looks a little ridiculous, it's alcohol-related.
I will say that each flask Since you're drinking from both of them, it would have a combination, not including this one, of 12 charges. And afterwards, you need to refill it. And it has to be quality whiskey that you refill it with. No other alcohol will work.
Finally, someone of class.
And for the name of the item, you can call it Punch Drunk.
Punch Drunk, I love that. That's great. All right. Add that to my trackers. On my way back, if I can just stop by wherever Simon is, I just want to ask her to drop off some brewing supplies, brewing kits to the ship. Probably two of them now, because I want one for rum and one for whiskey, see if I can make a quality in supplies to make a whiskey and rum.
She kind of gives you like a thumbs up and jots it down in her book.
Awesome. And I'm just going to hope I get paid before I have to pay her. Need that hazard pay.
So, in regards to camping gear, all of you have been supplied with a camping set. So that includes a bedroll and a tent, and a water skin. Also provided to the group is a... pretty much a campfire cooking set as well. That way you can prepare food and not have to survive off of travel rations. Speaking of that, because it is traveling on land, there's no telling when you're going to have to survive on rations alone. Each of you have been given 5 days worth of rations.
Go ahead.
Each one of these packs come with two basic health potions as well.
Yes, please.
As the captain, I demand all of you to give those to me.
I smash them in front of you.
Just open it up and pour it out on the ground in front of her.
But you have to make eye contact with her the entire time.
Yes. Yep.
Suddenly you see her psychic blade stab you in the back.
I don't think I'd see that if it was in my bag.
Exactly.
What was I going to say? Oh, the campfire cooking set. Does it also come with the means to start a campfire?
Yes. Yes, it comes with a flint, the flint and steel and everything like that. So you're not left high and dry trying to do it the old-fashioned way. Just rubbing this stick inside of the grass, trying to make some sort of spark.
Worst case scenario, I have some oil flasks, so maybe we just toss that on the fire and then set it on fire.
And it'll you said work. 5 days of rations?
Yes, 5 days of rations.
And if, like, I had amongst my belongings, I did have an explorer's pack, so I've got some of it, but so would that be a bonus to that, which would give me extra rope, or no extra rope with that?
The camping gear itself, there was no extra rope. There was just the tent, the bedroll, and the water skin, and then and then as a group, you got the cooking set, and then everybody got the two health potions. In regards to rope, each of you are given about a coil of 50 feet of rope, if you need it.
I'm not gonna take it. I have way too much rope to carry around. Then don't feel like I need to have 150 on me.
These, like, little personal pup tents, then?
Or is
it a group tent?
No, it's personal tents. Like,
so one person tent?
And they're all adjusted for the size of a person.
I have this tiny little tent. Okay.
Aww, you got a cute tent.
I'll take that 50 feet of rope and just place it on the ground and give one end to the crab and then watch as it, like, noodle slurps it into the bag.
You just see a little claw come out and it just pinches it and it just, you know, really quick unwinds and just gets slurped right into the bag.
And I'm just gonna be sitting there like this,
Char, like, we get that tent that's like only like chest to knees high. That's both ends sticking out. It's like, yep. Come on.
That is the cutest little thing. What is its name?
Oh, have you not met before?
No.
I'm going to take out the bag and just kind of place it down in front of Echo and tap on the opening.
And as Char taps on the opening, this little hermit crab like comes halfway out of the bag and sort of just like sits there looking at you with its claws up in the air, sort of just like snipping.
He offered it something, so I want to offer it something. I'll just pull out a piece of copper.
And like you pull out a piece of copper and his little claw just snips at the end of it and it vanishes.
I don't know what this is, but I'm in love with it.
That's what I thought when I saw it.
I love duffel crabs.
What's its name?
Oh, I was calling it a satchel crab, but duffel crab.
Yeah, they're called duffel crabs.
We haven't agreed on a name yet, I don't think, but I've been thinking about it.
You let me know when you decide its name.
He gave us the name.
Did he?
Jenka told you. I just did not write it down, so I forgot what it was. But yeah, no, he gave us the name.
That's right. Because you two had quite the discussion.
That's right.
Yep.
That's okay. I forgot to write it down, too. I
can't remember what it was.
We'll have to go back to one of the older VODs and find it.
The episode. Yep. Yeah.
Will I be naming him Lunch until otherwise informed?
You can't eat the crab.
I don't know if you want to get too close. Might pinch you and pull you into the bag.
Mm-hmm.
And I heard that these bags and living things don't get along. Well, except for the crab. It gets along in the bag.
You can see that, you know, that the idea of being pulled in where there was all the treasure... Cannonball looked happy for half a sec until you said living things don't go too well in there.
And that's the scary thing about duffel crabs, is they could pull people into the bag.
I mean, for all we know,
piss it off enough.
That petrified gnome wasn't petrified before the crab pulled it into the bag.
Oh yeah, it still has the petrified gnome in there.
Yeah, it does. I was double checking in chat with Shara to make sure that we were keeping the crab and the gnome, because I have future plans for the gnome.
Yeah. When you try and get stuff out of your bag, does he pinch you?
The first few times, yeah.
Yeah, it makes sense.
The first like day that I brought it back aboard the ship, it stole my axe.
Oh no.
Yeah. And then I got real upset because that's my axe. And I didn't know it was a magic bag, so I turned it inside out. Oh. And we found out exactly what was in that bag.
Insomnia Knight RPG, thank you for that raid.
Wow. And that sounds like an adventure.
As the two of you are talking, the crab kind of like begins to like skitter off a little bit. As a like the glint of all the scrap metal and stuff has started catching its attention as it starts slowly creeping over to over to just like a random pile of scrap.
Can I try and like catch it back in the bag? Just drop the bag down on top of it.
Oh no! It as it walks, the bag goes with it. It's like a hermit crab, so the bag is pretty much its home. Yes.
Hermit bag.
Mm-hmm.
I have lots of notes, but I don't have a name written down.
Try and pinch the bag and lift it up off the table slowly.
And as soon as you pick up the bag, it just ducks into it.
Yeah, maybe not such a good idea to let it roam around out here.
Oh, does it tend to steal things?
That's like what it lives for, yeah.
We could make a fun game for it.
You found
it. On the ship. We just line things up that we want to take and have it roam around the ship taking these things and see where we can lead it to.
You found your teacher. as far as learning
stuff. Yeah, the sleight of hand, yeah. See, I was thinking it would be great to just, like, go into a tavern and, like, subtly drop it down near the wall somewhere and just let it go wild.
Oh, that's a good idea, too.
At the end of the day, that sounds like a big payday to me.
Let's throw them in one of those fountains that has all the pennies at the bottom.
God. All of a sudden, the entire fountain just disappears.
Picturing the water squirting up from where it used to be.
Shara, maybe you should tell Echo about the gnome in the bag, just so she knows.
Oh, yeah, so when I turned the bag inside out and, like, everything came out of it, there was the statue of a gnome. Turns out it's not a statue, it's just a guy.
Hmm. You had some poor luck.
And it was, like, maybe even a captain of, like, one of the ships or something in Pearl's grandpa's fleet. We don't actually know, because he's still petrified. So we haven't been able to question him.
Petrification's something you can undo.
What we hear, yeah.
Yeah, I did talk to Bryant about it, but it's complicated. We could probably do it, but if it's one of my grandfather's captains, he was on a mission that I'm not too thrilled about. So, and as far as my grandfather knows, I'm dead or missing, and it's complicated. We'll leave him as a statue for a while.
Yeah, we're just holding on to him until we, you know, have the time and ability to ask him some questions.
Sounds like a plan, I guess.
Assuming, you know, he's actually still alive.
I mean, that's fair.
This the conversation goes on. Off in the distance, you hear just an roaring echo of a cannon shot going off a little inland.
Oh, that's right. We're supposed to be catching up to them, aren't we?
Are we actually traveling as we're talking, or
no? You're still at the scrapyard.
Oh, oops!
I got distracted by a crab.
I was gonna say, I was like, if I didn't realize we already left, there's one more thing I wanted to do.
Yeah.
But yeah, I'll run outside and see where that fire came from. The cannon. The bub.
Yeah, cannonball's right behind you on that one. He liked the detonation.
Oh.
I mean, it's literally the sound of an explosion. That's like fireworks to this man.
So,
it's fair.
You don't necessarily see anything that caused a cannon shot off in the distance for like a brief moment, and then out on the horizons, like across, like in the plains, you see what looks to be a boat on land.
If I use my spyglass, can I see more than that?
Most definitely.
A perception check, then?
You know what? I won't even make you roll, because, like, once it's pointed out, like, off in the distance, it just looks like there's a ship on land. You pull out the spyglass and you take a look, and it looks like somebody took the underpart of a hull and sort of fastened it onto two engine powered treads, allowing it to go across the land. The small, from what you can see out of one side where the smoke is coming from, there looks to be slits open on the side of this boat that seem to work as cannon holes.
And do I see anything that... Do I see any indication that there was a cannon or that a shot was fired at something in particular?
You can see a bit, you could see a little bit of like the residual smoke after a cannon goes off, sort of booming out of one of the rear slits on the ship. And then it stands out to you that this hull is sort of turned upside down, to where the underbelly is now the top side of this vehicle.
It's like a turtle shell.
Yeah, it's like a turtle shell, exactly. Sort of like they took just part of a hull of a ship and turned it upside down and then attached it onto these two treads.
Man, that ain't natural, but I like it.
I'll share the spyglass around so everyone can get a good look.
Okay, well, what I was joking about, he'll actually say in that case.
I think that's pretty safe to assume we know who's on that.
Yeah, Mama Plum, is that the thing that you mentioned?
She takes the spyglass and kind of looks. She's like, yep, that would be the rabble rouser.
But that's not too far off. We could probably catch it, like, relatively quickly if we left right away.
Maybe, depending on how hard they push it, they may have to let the engines cool for the night. Pyro hasn't really gotten the cooling system down just yet. Tends to run a little bit hot, and if it gets too hot, well, in typical Pyro fashion, it sort of explodes.
Do you think that noise that we heard was related to that in any way, or were they probably just shooting at something?
Oh no, that was definitely a cannon shot. They were shooting at something. My guess is Pyro is getting hungry.
In that case,
I will be right back.
Well, while our captain is going off somewhere, I'm ready to go. I don't know about you guys.
If possible, before we run off, I would like to have a quick perusal of the on-hand inventory.
Okay, what are you looking for?
Something sharp, preferably in the form of an axe.
Are you going down into the basement, or are you just perusing some of like the weapons that Pierce has made up in his shop?
Oh, let's go with what's up in the shop.
Okay.
Pearl's holding up a little flag that says basement.
I think everybody's doing that.
No, basement has... There's consequences for those.
Some of them.
Speaking of which, I probably should have asked, is that a bonus action or action, or what is it to use?
That's a free action.
Okay.
Because you got that straw, you can just pop that in your mouth and drink from it at will. So if you're just going to the shop, you can find, you know, basic weapons abound.
Nothing special.
Nothing special, no. These are just...
Then I will promptly head to the pit.
The pit.
Okay.
And you said... what type of axe are you looking for here?
Due to size constraints, I am limited to battle axe.
Okay, so you're looking for a battle axe.
Yes.
There's a really short handle. No, I'm sorry.
Giant axe, small handle. Got it.
It could be all blade for all I care.
You're a barbarian, right?
I am indeed.
Oh yeah, I forgot. This group has two barbarians.
I mean, swords are also fine, just it needs to have a blade. None of that blunt shit.
Okay. So Goa is, so if you're looking for a battle axe or any sort of axe-like weapon, go ahead and give me a investigation roll. Ooh, okay. So as you're perusing through it here, you find this strange contraption that looks like an axe. But with the way that it's set up and everything and the way that the haft itself is attached to the blade, it almost looks like one of those like lacrosse sticks. And you notice that up along like where the top hand would be when you go to swing this axe, there's a trigger. Just a small thing that you can grip onto if need be. Or just not grip, but squeeze.
Okay. So two-handed with a trigger.
Mm-hmm.
I need to press the trigger.
Okay.
I'm obligated to press the trigger.
And as soon as you
the bunny that wouldn't go into the basement.
As soon as you press the trigger, you see that the bit of the axe itself kind of like falls off of the axe, but it's now attached by this long cable. But the cable itself is now no longer like the axe bit itself has now transformed and sort of bent forward a little bit. As you can see these small rows of jagged teeth along the inside of like this newly formed mouth. And as soon as you like release the trigger, the wire comes zipping back into the haft, and the axe reattaches and forms back into like your basic axe bit. With this axe, what you can do is you can make a ranged attack up to 25 feet. Any creature that is hit by this thing is now grappled. And using a bonus action, you can pull that individual to you by releasing the trigger. Sort of acting as a gap closer for you.
What if I were to bun hop before I release the trigger?
You would be pulling them into the air.
Important questions.
This thing can
important questions.
This thing can move creatures of medium size and smaller at this moment. Though given the way that it looks, if you can find somebody who can work with it, you can definitely increase the torque on this thing to pull larger creatures.
Need. Much need. I'm going to happily carry that back up with me.
Okay. And when it's...
I didn't find anything else weird down there.
That's what you found. Okay. And when it you throw, like, you sling, like, the jaws at somebody, a successful hit will do a D8 piercing damage.
Okay. I assume I will get sent a proper list of how this thing works.
Yes.
Okay.
I'll send that to you, and I will also send the list for Punch Drunk as to what it does for Billy's character.
Love it.
Need. I don't know how much it is, but I want it.
Oh, they don't charge for anything down in the basement. You're just taking what could possibly be cursed items off of their hand.
Eh, fair enough. Could be worse.
But Mirror comes back up from the basement with a very strange looking battle axe, but seems to have a very pleased look on his face.
Smiles a bunny can get.
And Mama Plum looks over at everyone. So is there anything else you need before you set out?
I think we've got all the supplies that we need. That basement is always alluring, but perhaps after we come back.
It's always open.
Inka, in the meantime, is heading to the ship to give the crew a heads up as to what the hell's going on.
Okay. Are you delivering any sort of specific orders or just, you know, pretty much telling them to hang tight until you get back?
She doesn't know how long they will be. Because she doesn't know what the course of plan is going to be once they catch up to the others. So she's going to say to, you know, make sure that the ship is tidy. Keep an eye out for anyone who may attack. And to keep an eye and respect the parsnip family. Or the possum family. As they are allies to them.
And Esteban gives a soft chuckle, and he's like, don't worry on that end, Captain. We know better than to mess with Brian's family.
Good. Then we'll be back, and just keep everything in shape until then. Hopefully we'll be back soon.
And as you return, Rory meets up with you and the rest of the group, seemingly having her own gear set for travel, as the individual that met her at the dock is sort of waiting at the gate with the 20 individuals that you had rescued from Echo Bay. Well, this is goodbye for now. As soon as I make a landing in Tidefall, I will get a message out to you letting you know the situation in regards to the Ravans looking for us, and as soon as we find out any information whatsoever about this Whispered One or the goings on at Echo Bay or anything like that, I will be sure that you are the first to know. You have a lifeline with the Silver Tongue. If you are ever in need of a safe house for whatever reason, she reaches in and she hands Janka this small, it like fits in the palm of her hand, but it's definitely a Silver Tongue. Present these to our, I guess you would call them barflies. You can find them in any tavern across the continents themselves, like across the islands. They'll tend to have a small silver pin on the inside of the left collar of their shirts. They won't ask any questions. They will just simply take, they will just simply see the silver tongue and lead you to safety. Don't use this as a free hotel stay. This is for emergencies only.
Damn it. Alright. Will do.
Oh, I hope to see all of you soon. But until then, I will keep in contact from the Silver Tongue HQ.
Try not to ask your questions about the Ravans too loudly. We don't need them looking your way.
No, any questions I ask about the Ravans are going to be done within the safety of the HQ. But I have a feeling that once I arrive there, I will be assigned specifically into research of this Whispered One to see if we can't find anything else out about him, his true name, anything like that, anything that would give us a means to either seal him away or banish him.
We'll do our best to keep you updated about what we find.
Any information that you can provide would be wonderful.
Just do let us know when you get to the city safely.
I will.
And get sailed safely.
Keep an eye out on that bird, and you should see a message in the next couple days. Sort of like says her personal goodbyes to each of you and then begins to head off with her contact and the 20 survivors as they begin to make their way down the Tidelight. And as
thought we had those with us.
What's that?
I thought we had those people still.
No. She was taking them to Tidelight in order to get them resituated into society.
He's not taking them to the home of the sparkly vampires?
No. That's not on this continent. That's further north.
Okay. But yeah, they kind of stay out of the sun. They sparkle.
Yeah, exactly.
My God.
But yeah, so as the group begins to take their first steps outside of the Parsnip Scrapyard, heading inland for the first time, this is where we are going to leave off for this week. As I think HB Fox's camera froze for just a brief second. But yeah, so that
Fox is done with the shit.
That will do it for us tonight. Thank you very much, everyone, for tuning in as we have made our glorious return back to the Tricorn Isles. This is not the only game that we do. Coming up tomorrow should be another episode of Destiny Forge Campaign 3. And then on Saturday, we should have another episode coming up of Withered Wastes. And then we will circle back around here on Monday again for another episode of Tricorn Isles. And on Tuesday again with Destiny Forge. And then on the next Saturday will be another episode of Wayward Wanderers, which is a Pathfinder 2 Extinction Curse campaign that Azrin runs. Also, keep an eye out for information on an upcoming game that's as yet to be announced. But for now, we are going... Oh, also, if this is your first time here, we have all of our shows over on our YouTube channel, including all of our past campaigns, our one-shots, our holiday specials. Everything could be found over there. But now, We are going to head on out. Thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you tomorrow for another episode of Destiny Forge.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good one.